Oh, yeah? Well, me and the Lord, we got an understanding.
We're on a mission from God.
Time after time, I tell myself that I'm so lucky to be loving you. So lucky to be the one you run to see in the evening when the day is through. I only know what I know. The passing years will show if kept my love so young, so passing years will show if kept my love so young.
I'm going to record it.
That works.
Yeah, and then, okay. then we'll go live with all right, we're a pork and beans show.
Okay. How is our volume for you guys?
Good.
It's good.
And everything looks okay, sounds okay.
Video quality is really good. You got good equipment there.
We have a good Yeti microphone. It was not cheap, but it was worth its money.
And the hoop light.
You know. Oh, yeah, and the lights. And, yep, I got one Yeti. Just like that.
We got three Yeti microphones today.
Of course we do. It's a Sasquatch meeting.
Well, we're going to discuss the Pontee as well.
That too. That too.
We got to give people a little bit of, you know, that's one of my goals, because I've been on craft before, you know, and all that kind of stuff. So to me, there's like a one-on-one correlation. Like the Sasquatch, if they're not on the same team, they got the same plan, which is to help humans kind of wake up a little bit and be able to live next to non-human intelligent beings, you know?
Well, I think that there is a lot more correlation between the Sasquatch and our visiting nations than we are very aware of, because we know that they're both above ground and underground. There's an awful lot of folks that have facilities underground around the world as well that aren't from here, because they can climate control it. And so it
does environmental
control. Yeah, right. Yeah. So it doesn't surprise me. And then we see a lot of confusion for the other individuals that reside in the forest alongside the Sasquatch, more than the large individuals like the Dogman or the Saurons, but the little guys the Woodmen.
Yeah.
And we have lots of stories of things like that from at least around the Rocky Mountain area of the little guys. And in fact, the Cherokee used to trade with them because
the Crow.
Yeah, it was the Crow. I apologize. You're right. It was the Crow Nation.
Yeah.
They used to trade bird point arrowheads that are about this big.
About an inch.
Or less. Or half less, an inch. Yeah. And because they could nap them with their smaller hands. And so they would trade with the local populace bird point arrowheads for other things. And the Crows still talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
You think they're the Pontee or they're just some other nation?
I think that the Pontee also, at least in this area, we know that they're very involved with the Sasquatch. We know of the Sasquatch here in the big dormant super volcano.
Valles Caldera.
That's in north central New Mexico. Is a great big. How wide is the bowl of that crater? Mile plus?
20 miles.
I mean, just the bowl in the center.
20 miles.
Okay. We got a big crater, and the whole area is filled with lava tubes. And the whole area also is part and parcel of the ancient tunnel system that used to be here. And so we can talk about that too if you guys don't know about that.
Absolutely.
But, about it. We got this is an open show. We go usually 3 hours. So you're the one who's going to say, "Oh, I've
Well,
had
we
enough.
Can talk about ask lots of good questions, cuz I'll babble on."
Oh yeah.
You want to hear some, before the show starts, you want to hear something fun?
What?
Is the Pontee, right? They're teaching people how to do mind speak.
Yes. Right? Absolutely.
Well, the Sasquatch taught me how to go invisible.
Oh, fun.
Real big fun.
Oh, I bet it is.
The Sasquatch, I was watching a video about, they were talking, the lady was talking about for the Sasquatch about the heart, this and that. And they were talking about a heart light meditation that the Sasquatch did. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And I was sitting there, and as soon as they said that heart light meditation, and that's how you go invisible by filling the body with light. This, and I said, I could never do that. And as soon as I said I could never do that, this big, giant, invisible hand went right into my chest, right? And started taking over my breathing. I started breathing like a bellows, like this, right? And I started feeling this cool energy. It was like an initiation, right? Well, you know, long story short, it was about maybe 3 months later, they came back and did it again, right?
Oh,
and I was laying in bed. I started breathing really hard. You know, I was in my shorts, right? And I was like, I can't take it anymore. I was like, you know, but I knew that, you know, you surrender, right?
Right, right.
And then when I just about couldn't take it anymore, I sat up. And then when I looked at my legs, I only had one leg. One leg was completely disappeared.
Wow.
What was that, huh? So the Sasquatch and the ET are teaching people how to go mind speak and invisible. I mean, who knows what's going to happen in the future? It may take a while. For a human being to go invisible, you have to feel your entire body.
Yeah, it takes a lot. I've only known for sure one other person that I've met. Well, two that have the ability to do that, or I've witnessed it with my own eyes.
Humans.
This guy is one of them. Believe really? It or not. No kidding. No kidding.
Much respect.
Yeah. No, and that was, of course, he spent 40 some years now studying shamanism from all over the world, including a lot of the Peruvian stuff. And so his breadth of knowledge of energy work is stronger than most people's.
Oh, I love that. I love that. I love that. Because in my, what the Sasquatch showed me, right, was that from the time of Lemuria, every time the civilization fell, right,
mm-hmm.
the Sasquatch went and trained the shamans in energy work and in the history of the earth. And they trained, and the gurus went up to the holy mountains in India, and they were initiated back into, you know, into the Kriya, into the yoga of enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have been keeping humanity's spiritual pressure high for like 500 million years or 200 million
mm-hmm.
years.
Mm-hmm. And they've been around a long time doing that for us, and I suspect for the previous ages of man, plural.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, this goes back 250 million years.
Because mm-hmm, we're the fourth Earth human mammal age of man that's reached the ability to go beyond our own atmosphere. I don't know how far the other civilizations got, but prior to our doing it, the reptilians that were indigenous to Earth also got to that level and went out to the stars with help, just like we're doing.
Hey guys, we only got a minute to go. Let's
okay. Let's.
Sue Walker, and is it Reverend White Otter? Or
it's Reverend White Otter.
Mm-hmm. Okay, mm-hmm. Because he's obviously, thankfully, going to be
commits from the sidelines.
I'm so excited.
I'm surrounded by
you. Got two people. You
guys.
Got two people on the same show who've been able to get some part of themselves go invisible.
I'm just hoping that you can go invisible for a whole show, Beans.
Now I'm here, the mystery man. That's my invisible form.
Hello, mystery man. He's gone invisible.
Hey, yeah, go invisible on the show, Beans.
And we got what?
Here we go. We're going live now.
Four people on the same show who've had mind speak. How cool is that?
Mm-hmm. At least
I always speak my mind. Sometimes you don't appreciate. Sometimes you don't appreciate it.
That's why the Sasquatch just give you buzz anymore. They don't want to hear it anymore. They just give you a buzz feeling.
This is going to be a show of shows. I can tell already. I love
I got a scoop shovel by the door.
This is it, the night of nights. And oh, what nights we'll hit. On with the show. This is it.
Nice baritone.
There we go.
Put the lime in the coconut. Drink them both up. Put the lime in the coconut.
Call the
doctor up. Say, doctor. Ain't there something I can do? I said, doctor, to relieve my belly.
Eat more beans.
All right. Everybody, Thanks for dropping in. This is my name is Port Cunningham, and I'm here with my distinguished, honorable co-host, the world's handsomest man, Frank Oliver Baines. And we're here with Sue Walker and Reverend White Otter. And we're going to be talking about Sasquatch and the Pawnee people and all kinds of stuff.
And artwork.
And we're going to try to get Beans to go invisible.
That sounds like a good plan. Your show will be infamous before it's famous. Oh, did I say that backwards?
Well, you should have seen our first couple of shows. If you think this is a disaster, you should have seen it when we first started.
I got an inflamed something that rhymes with famous.
They have cures for that these days.
Yeah.
Lime and coconut.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
I don't know, but you want to put a lime down there. Does that cure
it? The image is, guys,
that's wet wipes.
Oh, golly. No. I'm surrounded. Oh, yeah, well, hi, everybody.
Lucky you, eh, Sue? Surrounded by three amazing gentlemen. Well,
I would hate to have all three of you around the same dinner table. I can just see all the stuff.
It's all Hayoka.
Oh, my God.
It's all Hayoka.
It is all Hayoka. Oh, back up. Do you know the word Hayoka?
No.
Okay. Hayoka is a Lakota Sioux word that means sacred clown. And Hayoka specifically use humor as a teaching methodology. So if you learn something with humor, it's more likely to stick than if you learn something just via rote. So the three of you would fall into the category of sacred clown and would be the ones clowning around with each other on a regular basis, but talking real important talk at the same time. So that's Hayoka.
Hey, but we've got the king of the sacred clowns here. We got RE right on my, is it my right shoulder or left shoulder?
That, it is over your left shoulder.
He's the king of the clowns.
That face in the rock. Have your listeners seen that rock before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah. I thought they had. Because I remember when you showed it to me, I just looked at it and went, that is so classical Sasquatch artwork. It's not even funny. The Sasquatch frequently will find things with faces in them and place them specifically. And sometimes we see them chiseling and stippling faces, or in addition to faces. We've got evidence up in Colorado of where they've taken a rock and banged it against another rock repeatedly to stipple a different texture pattern into a face. And so that kind of artwork is just amazing to me, but it's part and parcel of their world because the faces in the rocks, in the landscape, in the mountains are all ways that they navigate from point A to point B. They have names for all of these faces. They have stories and histories behind them, just like you and I might have a famous street in our town named after a former resident or somebody who did something important for the town. They name the faces in the landscape around them and refer to them and the stories around them. And that's how they navigate and talk to each other about, yeah, go down to Great Aunt Matilda's face and then turn left at Uncle Frank's and go about. And it's their way of naming the landscape in ways that everybody knows and understands and remembers.
Well, when I had my first visual sighting of him, it was right at that exact spot, just back in the bush, just behind that. So, yeah.
Beautiful rock. Beautiful face on there. Just stunning. Mm-hmm. Stunning. Yeah.
Thank you. So let's talk about you and Reverend White Otter a little bit. How did you guys get all weird?
like the rest of us in a beautiful way.
I started out all weird as a youngster. Did you? I did. I was very young when I had my first ET encounter. And that would have been somewhere between ages 3.5 and 4. And then it continued on and off as I was growing up. And it wasn't until, 1998, it shifted from in the background to more in the foreground. But at that point in time, I had already been in my profession as clairvoyant and medical intuitive for almost 8 years, about 8 years by that point in time. And since then, have spent a lot of time learning about all kinds of spirituality and shamanic systems and that sort of thing. This guy also is an ET experiencer from very young. And Otter is the mystery man this way. If you see me pointing this way, I'm pointing at my spouse.
We see a part of an arm, so we know there's somebody
there. Yep, there is somebody there. And then if you see me pointing this way, this is out my picture window looking at the Sandia Mountain. So when he and I met, he'd already been studying shamanism, had been to Peru and back twice to do ceremony with them. In the meantime, I had spent time learning Native American spirituality with some Lakota friends and doing ceremony with them. And he and I met after I'd had 25 years as a professional psychic and medical intuitive, and he'd spent 30 years doing shamanism. So when we first got together, we had a lot in common already to talk about, and then started realizing that we came at the same understanding from two different pathways.
Is a medical intuitive, is that like a healer?
I know how to do that kind of energy work, but a medical intuitive technically is much more like a walking, talking CAT scan. Somebody who can see and describe what's going on within a physical body.
Oh, wow. And then you can also do some healing work, I imagine, too, right?
I can, but I never delved into that professionally. I just worked on friends and family. And Otter's learned a lot of Reiki work from about age, 40 on?
Yeah.
So over the last 30 plus years, he's steeped himself in that kind of energy work and then added to it after that. Mine was much more eclectic. I found people from all different kinds of energy disciplines and had them show me their brand of energy work so that I could understand what it was, how it worked, and how to do it. Yeah. So,
The Sasquatch have actually been working with me with opening up my healing abilities. So
good,
you know, because they're amazing healers, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, they can. Yeah. I mean, I've heard too many stories and experienced like live. Oh, there I go again. They're giving me that energy, full body rush.
See, no mind speak. Just they don't want to hear from. They just want to give an energy.
No, they do occasionally, but it's mostly energy, right? And that's healing is energy or whatever too. But you know, you said Lakota, eh? Lakota?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know I have a friend who is a direct descendant of Crazy Horse.
Okay.
And okay. I've actually been in contact with Crazy Horse a few times, like his spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And wow, it's just some amazing stuff. Like he was like the, well, my friend called him like the Jesus of their people, whatever. He was a very, that's what they thought of him as anyway.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Very powerful man, even now, even in spirit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Most definitely.
I was just really, really blessed to be brought into a traditional Native American spirituality work by a gentleman who was a medicine man practicing in central Iowa, who was from the Crow Creek band of the Lakota Nations, and then went from there to meet other people involved with their ceremonies and learned those. And in fact, the Lakota language that I know how to speak, I learned because I was taught the traditional songs to sing in sweat lodge or inipi, that's the other word for sweat lodge, or in sacred ceremony like a sundance, because there are separate songs for each of mm-hmm. the sacred ceremonies. And so I learned how to sing those words properly and then put the understanding of the meaning behind them. And so that's the way I came about the little bit of Lakota that I know how to speak.
Can you give us a Lakota greeting?
Yatahe? Oh, no, that would be the Navajo. Yes. Sorry, I've been down here in the Southwest too far or too long. Yatahe is Navajo, and all the Pueblo people down in this area would commonly use it to say hi. So right now, right off the top of my head, I'll have to think about greetings. I know how to say things like colors or animals or
any Lakota words.
Well, okay. I was drawing one of the Sasquatch one time, and he was from up in that general vicinity. And when I asked him what his name was, he said Chensapa, which means black tree in Lakota, or tree black. Chen Sapa. Sapa is black. And so when he said that, I said, your name is Black Tree. And he looked at himself, and he was one of the big, black, short-haired Sasquatch. And he went, yes. He was one of the rounder-headed Sasquatch instead of the tall, conical-headed Sasquatch. And his territory was along the rivers that separate South Dakota from the state to the south of that, which is what, Nebraska.
Mm-hmm.
So that was his territory, and ran right along the southern edge of South Dakota and all of the Lakota territories. So yeah, that's part of, and when he said it, it didn't surprise me, because we know that the Sasquatch all over the planet borrow smatterings of words from local languages. That's just not uncommon to hear an English word or a Lakota word or another language that is local to wherever their area is.
Yeah.
So
remember that Navy guy that was had the voice recordings that they worked with and slowed them down?
Oh yeah.
I know the guy's name. What's his name? He was a linguist.
Yes, yeah. He was. That's exactly right.
And yeah, I remember a little bit of the story behind it, Otter. He got a hold of some of Ron Moorhead's
mm-hmm.
Sierra sounds.
I think so, yes.
And he looked at them and he thought, I'm not going to find anything. He was kind of like, you know, skeptical. But then mm-hmm. when he looked at it with his knowledge of linguist,
mm-hmm. linguistics,
he said, wait a minute. This is an actual language here. This is not just random stuff. And right. His name was, what was his name?
I had it. If you don't think about it, it'll come.
It'll come to me later, yeah. So how many different types of Sasquatch people do you think there are in the world? I mean.
Wow.
Or
plans? Gee.
No. I mean, are they all, species, no, what nature? I mean is, are they all the same? Like, are the Yeti and the Sasquatch and the Yowie, are they all, are there differences?
There are slight differences. As far as I can tell, they can all interbreed with one another, but that doesn't necessarily mean that their offspring have reproductive capabilities. Just like you can breed a horse and a zebra, but the offspring does not produce.
Sterile.
Yeah, it's sterile. The Ponte tell us that there are seven distinguishably separate nations here on Earth right now. I don't know that you can say it's limited to that if you go above or beyond our planet, because we know that they travel with our extraterrestrial friends. We just seldom see them in a craft of their own where they are the pilots. That's more unusual. But as far as nations here are concerned, they first divide it between the round-headed folks and the conical-headed folks that have the extra cranial capacity and larger brain size. And then they break it down from there because there are some Sasquatch that have a much more human-looking face than, let's say, a grade ape kind of face. And then there are others where they're so covered with hair that there's just no question. We see a variety of hair from stopping and starting here under the eyes to the jawline to the whole face being hairy sometimes. And then we also see different patterns with the youth or the children, and then the hair on their face changes as they age. We're still seeing all of the natural hair color spectrums that you and I have across the planet in the Sasquatch all over, as well as textures. About the only thing we haven't found exactly yet is the super curly, kinky hair we see in some Earth humans. That's dark. Most of it is wavy or fairly straight, especially if it's short.
That goes along with the concept of the light shaft, the hollow.
Yes, right, right.
That's why those straighter hair.
And I don't know if all of those nations have the middle of the shaft of the hair different or distinctly different from our hair or a great ape's hair. Versus there is a difference in how the inner shaft of the hair strand reflects light or deals with light, I'm going to say it that way, than with our hair. So whether they all have that different hair shaft, I can't tell you for sure yet. I know that we find it a lot in North America. I don't know, and I haven't checked with our Australian friends yet to see it's of the prevalence in the Yowie. But as we've talked with Australian Sasquatch researchers, they talk about everything from the little bitty woodman up to the 20-foot tall guys too. And they also talk about the round-headed versus the conical-headed Sasquatch in Australia as well. So we're seeing a diversity in just about every continent. Don't know anything about Antarctica yet, but don't know if we can discount it only because so much happens underground that we never see.
Yeah.
And so we don't know if there is an underground to that area that would be habitable and have a food source. That's a good question. No idea.
Yeah. You think the difference in size sometimes, you got a question, I know, Beans. hold that thought. Do you think the difference in size sometimes is to do with climate and whatever? Because they're bigger up north at times, you know, than they are down south. Is that because they need a bigger body mass to, you know, for weather and stuff like of that nature?
I think it's
I'm not saying that right, but you know what I'm going.
Yeah, I think you're on track partially. But I think there's also a genetics component to it, just like there is with us. You can give me as much nutrition as possible, but because of my genetics with my parents and my grandparents, I will only reach my own maximum kind of height. It's not like I'm going to grow a foot or 2 feet above my parents just because of having the right nutrition or having the right environment. I think it has to be a measure of food source, environmental niche, and genetics. All of the above play a role.
Now, just to wrap this kind of thing up, and then Beans, you got a question, right?
I have a question.
Yeah, but I just wanted to ask you. So it seems to be that even though you can find ones that look more ape-like and even in families or whatever, I think that's an ancient one kind of thing in some ways, you know, the differences can be that, like RE, for instance, is probably an ancient one, or is an ancient one, but
I think so.
but I think basically it's the same kind of Sasquatch people, you know, on the West Coast. But then, you know, you go to like the Skunk Ape in Florida. That seems to be a different kind of.
We've learned from our Sasquatch friends that it is not uncommon when the Sasquatch get to that teenager, young 20-something age, that they travel to another area and return just to see what another clan's environment looks like and how they behave and what their culture is. It would be like you and I traveling to, say, the middle of Africa and experiencing that kind of a culture and environment and then coming back home. We just need to see how other people live and work, and the Sasquatch do the same thing. But I think that it goes a little bit farther than that. I suspect that the interaction between faraway clans has something to do with not so much interbreeding and right. diversity of genetics as well.
Right. I've heard that too. They will go to to like my female, Ari's daughter. I can't say my female, but the female I but Raja Say. It's my understanding that she went to Oklahoma, and now her mate Fortuna is back here, and it is for the gene pool or whatever.
Right, and the cultural learning too. I think that it's a measure of both. We see a lot of similarities when we compare building styles across continents. If you qualify it to, let's say, building styles 8,000 feet and higher, I can compare Europe, Asia, North America, and find a lot of similarities in the types of structures that are created in that kind of an environmental niche versus, say, swamp in Florida or the whole bayou area in the South.
Right.
That kind of a building or environmental living niche. We would have to look to other swamp type areas on other continents to see something similar. So they've graduated to or give us evidence that they're sharing knowledge across continents.
Yeah.
In structure styles, as in what works for you in your environment. Let me try that here.
Yeah.
And they share things like that. There's more in common that way than there is in similar, although I have to qualify it, because things that we see that cross environmental niches are things like the roots of trees upside down, stuck in the ground with the roots sticking straight up in the air. That kind of thing, no matter where we go, we can find evidence of it. It's not totally common, but it still is findable. And so it tells me that there's communication happening all across the world with each other. And that merges over into the mind speak telepathic aspect of the Sasquatch culture, because we know they can talk out loud. We know that they have their own languages and their own words for things. We know that they borrow words from whatever local earth language, earth human language there is. But we also are very aware that their mind speak ability and ability to control you is the same as our extraterrestrial friends.
Yes.
They're a telepathic nation too. They have those same, let me reach into your thoughts and understand what makes you tick so that I can know how to interact with you.
Yes, absolutely. I've experienced that all the time. Yeah. That's exactly how it works. I wanted to ask you, but I want Beans to get his question in first.
Yeah.
But remember, I want to ask you something about ancient ones and stuff, but go ahead, Beans.
Go ahead. Are you finished?
Well, I didn't want to. Do you want to ask before I bring up the ancient ones, or do you want, or should I just?
I have a good question. And
go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. And then I'll.
And mostly it's for Reverend Whitewater. The question is this, let me preface a little bit. I've done a lot of research into the ET thing. You know, that's like a popular thing is the UFOs and stuff. And the whole world has these researchers, and there's researcher conventions on UFOs. And then now there's the Sasquatch people, as that's been going on for 40, 50 years, of the researchers and all this kind of stuff. And my question is this. For 500 years, we've invaded or lived alongside the Indian people. And the Indian people know everything there is to know about the Sasquatch people. And they exactly. and they know more than almost any other group of people in the world about the star people. Mm-hmm. How come, what is it, how come the Anglo-American people can't figure out to just go and talk to the Indians and find out what's going on? That's my
Christianity
question.
Is the primary answer.
That, and I think when the Europeans came over, they egotistically took the approach that if you had an oral history instead of a written one, that an oral history was worthless. Might as well just throw it out like garbage. It was only considered that an indigenous culture was, quote, intelligent, unquote, if they had a written tradition. And even then, they came across written traditions, and if they didn't like what they saw, they destroyed the libraries. We saw that happen.
In Alexandria.
In Alexandria, but we also saw it happen when they came over to the Americas and ran across the Mayans and the Incas. Their libraries were immediately burned by the church,
mm-hmm.
by the missionaries. And so they were considered demonic because they were not Christian-based and because they came from savages.
It just so doesn't seem fair to me. I mean, right now, the biggest topic is we're destroying the earth and we're not doing good with ecology and all this kind of stuff. And the First Nations people, the Indian people, they've known how to live, and the Sasquatch people, they've known how to live with this earth and leave it intact and pristine, you know? And it's taken us 500 years to try to begin to like shift over into what the tribal people already know.
Yeah. Exactly. I mean, there are stories all up and down the East Coast and Eastern Woodland Indians about creatures similar or just like Sasquatches and their involvement with the different tribes, let alone their own connection to the stars and the star nations. Depending, Cherokee look to the Dog Star a lot. And so on down the line.
They found bones, okay? They found bones of humans, anatomically correct, modern humans. They were 220,000 years old in America, in Mexico, mm-hmm. okay? So that's just like a baseline of how long this has been going on.
Well, they don't tell you about the giants they dug up in New Mexico either.
I mean, they dug up giants all over.
There's over 200 locations of where the giants are, and sometimes they find up to 200 different bodies, mm-hmm. 200 locations in America. So that's like another whole. That's another whole thing.
That's another whole world unto itself, right? And then we talk to Native American peoples who have very old stories that talk about dealing with giants that are not Sasquatch.
They're aliens.
The red-haired giants that have mm-hmm. six fingers and double rows of teeth were something that the Earth humans that were smaller, like us, avoided. And there are cannibalistic stories here in the desert southwest of those taller giants, and that they avoided them like the plague. Now, I can't say that the tall giants, and we're talking about the guys that are anything from 15 to 25 feet tall, all right? Those are the skeletons that we're aware of that were dug up here and absconded with somewhere. We just don't exactly know where. It makes me wonder about the mound builders and whether or not some of those sites dealt with the six-fingered giants or not. And I don't know if I can say one way or the other if those giant nations had elongated skulls. Do you guys know?
I don't think they do. Some did, okay, but most of them didn't. The ones that were like 10 foot tall, so they had a regular human type skull.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another side question to that. Is everything that the Sasquatch people can do in terms of invisibility and cloaking and mind speak and healing and all that kind of stuff, and everything that the star people can do, is it true that there are the First Nations shaman people who can do the same thing?
Mm-hmm.
So you want to handle yes. that?
That's a yes, right?
Yeah.
In my opinion and understanding, yes.
Yes.
What kinds of things are you talking about?
I think this is real important because of the mind speak and the going invisible and all the kind of stuff that's associated with both the ET people and the Sasquatch people. I think it's important that people know that human beings, normal, anatomically modern human beings can do and still are doing the exact same things that the star people can do and that the Sasquatch people are said to be doing.
And one of the big things you didn't mention is like shape-shifting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's a whole nother genre that
shape-shifting that's not the wicked kind. There's
correct. No. Thank you for qualifying that.
Now, the shape-shifting.
Oh, go ahead, Otter.
It's an interesting thing you brought that up, because I've been doing quite a bit of looking into that myself, and have come to a more of an understanding that we're dabbling with pieces of our DNA that represent other creatures, other plant material, other things, as far as mind speak, as far as connections spiritually, and so on.
When I think
I just want to say about the shape shifting thing. Like my experience with my clan is, I've had so many experiences where I knew for a fact they were either looking through the eyes of a raven or an owl or something, and in many cases they were actually had shape shifted into them.
It's called remote viewing.
Right, right, yes.
You and I are both capable of connecting with an eagle in the sky, a hawk, a pigeon, a raven, or whoever else is flying around out there, and asking their permission to look through their eyes at what they see.
You know, that's interesting, Otter, because I've had all kinds of like little weird like glimpses of maybe abilities that I might develop or whatever, something like and then some of them haven't come into play or whatever yet. But one time I don't know how I got it. I just got this knowing, and it was like a weird energy. I can't even describe it exactly now. It was so bizarre, but it was like, I got this message. You're going to be able to see through the eyes of animals. Like, you know, like the Sasquatch do. And I guess, you know, so I don't know when that's going to come on board, but I did get that message, and it was something else.
You need to work with it.
Mm-hmm. That's a practice thing.
You need
thing.
To work with the energy of it.
That's a practice thing.
Yeah.
Telepathy and having a clear telepathic rapport, both sending and receiving, makes a huge difference.
Mm-hmm.
And the more practiced you are that way, the easier it is. To me, it's a really fair question to say, is something shape-shifting into another animal, or are they simply using another animal as their eyes and telepathically connecting to them and saying, okay, now go over here and look at this. All right, now come back to this spot.
I think both happen for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's either. I think it's both. Well, how about you, Otter?
Yeah, I do. I have to agree that it's both. But as I started to explain, you know, when we get off in these side stems of our DNA, tracks and look at the pairs, and you start breaking them down. And some of those pairs are pairs, the minor ones are pairs of wolves, bears, deer, elk, and so on down the line. And as we begin to recognize that portion of DNA within us and connect with it, we begin to be able to take on that shape of that creature.
It's an interesting thought. And the one thing that historically makes me want to think about that, do you know about the rose quartz obelisk that came out of Chavín in Peru, South America? Mm. Are you familiar with that stone?
Oh.
All right. You know what an obelisk is, tall, pyramidal, skinny thing with a point at the top. All right. There was one they found in a temple in Chavín that was made entirely of rose quartz. The thing was huge, but carved on all of its faceted sides from top at the point down to the bottom are the progressive steps of man turning into jaguar and jaguar turning back into man.
Wow.
Yes, which makes me go, okay, somebody somewhere understood this enough to illustrate it. What's going on here? Who were these folks?
Put it in stone.
Yes, exactly, so that it
would
be lost.
So everybody would know, right.
Yes.
Would not be lost.
Yes.
And I've actually heard, okay, go ahead, continuing on that thought, or?
Go ahead.
I was going to say that I've heard of people, I've heard of accounts of people who have actually seen Sasquatch turning into other animals or whatever, actually in the transformation stage. Or
wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So it is a definite thing. It is
okay.
I, you know,
all right. That's a new piece for me. I hadn't heard anybody talk about witnessing that kind of thing or catching it on film at all. I understood the transdimensional or going from physically visible to our eye spectrum to not, and whether or not they just shift out of the spectrum that we can see or whether or not they actually shift dimensions. I think those are two different things.
Yeah. And they can also travel in orb form, I believe.
Yes, I understand that as well. And we've witnessed that kind of thing before.
You know,
that was fun.
I want to, even though I've shared this before, I'll keep it really, really brief, but I think you would be interested in this. And you know, I'm sure it's nothing that you haven't considered or know, but
you said keep it brief.
Yeah. I've seen orbs. My wife and I one time were taking pictures of orbs, right? Well, we just decided let's take, you know how it works. You get thought placement. You know how thought placement works, and then all of a sudden stuff happens, right?
Mm-hmm.
Thought placement is placed there for a purpose. So we decided we're going to take some pictures of orbs, see them coming in more and more and more, and then all these orbs formed into one powerful entity or whatever, and we could see them coming in from different points of consciousness. And that was the lesson I got there.
Wow.
This powerful entity consciousness was forming into this one being, but it was coming in from all different points of consciousness. That's pretty profound. That's the lesson I got from that.
That's neat.
That's very similar to Darrell standing out in the parking lot.
I was just
asking them to make faces and do things.
All right. So our story is very similar to yours.
Sure.
We have a friend who is a paranormal photographer who specializes in orb photography, and he has tens of thousands of photos.
I know who he is.
Okay.
I know who he is. He's from the conference, right?
Darrell Stokes is his name, African American
yeah.
gentleman. Yeah. Big smile. All right. So
yeah,
Darrell
right.
took us hell. To a natural spring outside of Sedona. Angel Springs, right. And so we were there at sunset, and like most places we go, we left an offering for the local woodman or whoever was there, because we wanted to thank them for taking care of the water. And as we were leaving, Darrell was the last one in the line heading back out to the path to head back to his house. And we both turned around and he snapped two or three last photos. One of the photos has a string of orbs perfectly making a heart shape over where we left them, the gifts. That was the first time I had ever seen a group of orbs work together to create an image. So Darrell and I sat down and had a discussion about that. And I said, when we are at the Sasquatch conference in Chewela, why don't we see if we can ask them to work together to form a three-dimensional image that you can take a picture of? Mm-hmm. Do you think we could do that? He said, we can try. And so what we were looking for is, can all of these spiritual entities work together and quickly come to an agreement to form a single image? And we found out that, by golly, yes, they sure can. So very similar to what you were talking about, we were asking them to form an image so that we understood what they looked like.
Yeah.
We were not going to predispose ourselves to think that they might form a Sasquatch image or another kind of human image or an ET image. We went into it with no preconceived notions. And what we got back was just intriguing.
But in my opinion, and you know this too, it goes deeper than that. I think that they gave you that idea, put that thought in your head, we should try this, because they wanted to show you that.
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
We have a history when we go to a Sasquatch conference where the Sasquatch interacted with folks at the conference up in Washington State. The first year, I thought and thought and thought about what could I bring that would be a joyful thing to share with them that doesn't involve food. Okay. What might be something that parents, teenagers, Sasquatch kids would all enjoy? What would that be? And so we talked to our extraterrestrial friends, and we had a really interesting discussion about what they called universal joys, things that crossed species that put a big smile on everybody's face, no matter if you were a dog, a cat, a Sasquatch, an Earth human, whatever. What were things that could bring universal joy?
Slinky.
That's not a bad choice, to be honest, because it's a sacred geometry shape.
Oh, okay.
Playing ball, playing with a ball.
We thought about that too. We brought soap bubbles.
Whoa.
Because blowing bubbles, if you blow bubbles in front of your Labrador Retriever, what do? They go chase the bubbles, right?
They start snapping at them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they think it's cool. They're fun. If you blow bubbles in front of a toddler, what do? They try and reach out and grab them. If you blow bubbles in front of a Sasquatch child, what do you think happens? They want to play with them. So we invited everybody who wanted to come down and play with bubbles that we were blowing in the parking lot so that there was lots of room.
Just about dusk.
And we put Darrell Stokes onto photography duty. And what we got were images of me blowing bubbles and bubbles being right next to orbs. And so you have both in the same frame and can see the difference. And that was what we were trying to capture. But we challenged the kids or anybody who was wanting to play with the bubbles, how long can they keep them going? How far can they make them travel before they pop? Just like you do with your own kids. And we had a blast. So universal joys, that's a real fun topic. So stuff that we do.
Sorry, I was just trying to look for a picture that Darrell took of me at Chewela.
Mm-hmm.
I went there one time and I met you guys briefly.
Mm-hmm.
And if you guys get into a conversation, I'll
If you can.
I'll ask a question about we just danced around this whole issue, which is one of the core issues of the Sasquatch and the First Nations people.
What's that?
And that is about being in your heart, and that Everything is one. Everything is your brother. The tree, the moose, the dog, the cat, mm-hmm. the crow. We're all one. And that, you know, when I first started connecting to the Sasquatch people, it took them 2 years to really explain to me without words about the all one and no space. And most people understand about the all one, but they really brought it home to me with the no space, meaning there is no, for them, where they live is no space, meaning there is not me, computer, you, your computer to you. That's the space. They don't have that. They're right. There is no space for them, you know, and that means they're, to be all one means to be all one like that. And you can't do that unless you're in your heart. This is also one of the fundamental principles of all the American Indian cultures that I've ever heard of. It's about the fundamental unity of all things. We are all brothers. We are all one. Mm-hmm. Even though we fight with each other, we're still all one. And to me, that's just so profound, you know, that I don't know if the Sasquatch people are in the star, and the star people do the same thing. Why are you coming here? Right. And they go, because you are our brothers.
Mm-hmm.
You are, you know, we are you in the future. You know,
the loose translation that they use when they come across another nation that they haven't met before is, in general, the translation would be, hi, cousin. It's an assumption that somewhere in our background, there's an overlap enough that we can call each other by distant relative names, cousins, brother, sister, family. And so the loose term or the loose translation of, hi, cuz, we also see in the Native American peoples from at least North America. Mm-hmm. I don't know about the other continents, but that standing of, I know I'm related to you somehow.
Mm-hmm.
We'll figure it out. Is part and parcel of all of that. And I agree, the Sasquatch, our understanding of that partially because of that telepathic rapport, they can see deeper, farther. But also, when we talk to our ET friends, the Ponte, about what you're referring to as mind speak or telepathy, the translation of their phrase for mind speak is infinite voice. If you have telepathy, you have infinite voice. And that kind of goes right in line with the there's no space.
Mm-hmm.
It's all there. It's all connected. It's all deeply embedded.
It's all time.
Mm-hmm. All time. All time is happening now. There is no linear time.
Well, if there's no space, there's no time, because if the time has to do about moving from one place, one space to another space through, you know what I mean, through time. Mm-hmm. But if there is no space, then there is no time. And that's really fundamental to the things that Sasquatch can do and the ET people can do, because the ET people can pick up 1,000 people in a night.
Mm-hmm.
In an 8-hour shift.
Mm-hmm.
And how do they do that? Because they keep going back to the same time.
Mm-hmm. Right?
They're not stuck in the same kind of time that we are in.
We've had discussions with at least the Ponte about time travel.
Mm-hmm.
And ask them, do they do that? Is that possible? Is that a thing? And what they say is, yes, it's possible. No, we don't encourage it, because there are an awful lot of factors that it messes up if you keep going, doing exactly what you talked about, going back to the same time,
mm-hmm.
time after time after time, exactly. They, our understanding of being able to see through time, and I find them doing that much easier than, quote, traveling through time or doing that kind of a shift to, say, pop back 200 years into the past and then pop back to now. I don't see that being talked about by them or occurring. But we do see the no space, being able to call home, so to speak, telepathically, and talk to relatives or family members long distance
at any point is no problem for them. That's the same. It's the same as remote viewing. You can go to any place and any time.
Well, you and I know telepathically, spiritually, energetically, we can call up somebody to talk to.
Oh, yeah.
If you want to talk to Crazy Crow, talk to Crazy Crow. You want to talk to, you know, whoever. If you develop a relationship, you can call and talk to anybody you want.
Just as a matter of learning how,
right? That's right.
Dialing it in, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So we have for your listeners a resource if they want to learn how to do telepathy themselves. There is a free book online called the Telepathy 101 Primer. And if you go to the website officialfirstcontact.com, you'll see it able to, you can download a version in more than a dozen Earth languages now. That Telepathy 101 Primer was written and by one of our
dictated
by a woman who is not from here. She is one of our Ponte friends from the Zeta Reticuli 2 area, and we helped her translate that and then find photos to go with her verbal translation and helped her put that publication out in December of 2017, along with protocols to follow for, do you want to invite our extraterrestrial friends to come visit you at your house or your CE5 gathering?
As a class in mental telepathy, mm-hmm, and an introduction to the Ponte.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We've been talking for almost an hour now. Why don't you, since you brought this subject up, I think it's probably one of the most important kind of topic that we're going to talk about today is that, hey, people, there are ways, there are people who can teach you mental telepathy and you have good results. So why don't you go back and tell the whole story of the Ponte and you and...
Sure. We were introduced formally to the Ponte back in 2013, starting in September of that year. I came visiting Otter here at this home in the Albuquerque area, and I came down from central Iowa. I had been here about 10 days when I first started hearing the voice of someone else who was not in the room with us. And the third time I finally heard this same male voice, I figured I better ask Otter. And he'd been hearing these voices, these peoples, since he moved into this house in 2009. So he and I talked about hearing the very same individual, okay? That individual we gave a nickname of Sandia to, because both of us recognized that the voice came from beneath the Sandia Mountain, which is on the eastern edge of the greater Albuquerque metro area. We live about 10 miles from it, but we have a clear view of the whole western face of the mountain. We recognized that this voice was not a ghost. It was not a spirit only. There had somebody with a physical body that was talking to us very clearly, very loudly, very gently in our home and knew what we were doing in our home. And I thought, okay, what are the odds here of what this could be? This is New Mexico. This is the land of strange things that happen underground and lots of scientific stuff. But it's also the land of Roswell and ET. Is that what we're dealing with here? And it wasn't until 2 months later that we finally asked this male voice what his real name was and where home was. And he answered in detail and indicated his real name was pronounced Tilkum. And we finally phonetically wrote it out, T-L-K-M, at his request. That's how he spelled it. And he said, home is the fifth planet orbiting the further of the two stars in the binary system you call Zeta Reticuli. And so he classically looks like what most people here in the United States would term a, quote, gray, unquote. Very large eyes, very dark covers over those eyes to make them look all black. Those are, by the way, a second eyelid, just like we have fish and amphibians and birds here in on Earth that have a second eyelid.
Nictitating
lens, right? It's a retractable lens. You and I also have a second, what they call vestigial eyelid. If you look way in the corner, on the inside corner of your eye, you see the remnants of our second eyelid that went the same way our appendixes went. When we didn't need them, they slowly started to phase out. And so the Ponte have a dark nictitating lens like built-in sunglasses that they cover their very large eyes with. And their eye colors beneath those dark lenses are run all the same colors that ours have, browns and blues and greens. But they also have more of a gold amber tone and also more of a violet tone, purplish tone. Other than that, their eyes are very sensitive because their world is considerably not the same light spectrum as our sun. And so when they go outside, they need to cover their eyes, one, to keep them moist, and two, to keep them protected. The Ponte have four fingers, four toes on each hand. They average somewhere between 4 and 4.5 feet tall.
Do they have thumbs?
You know, we have seen images of some of the Zetas that do appear to have thumbs. What the Ponte told us is of their four fingers, if you look like this, normally you would see a thumb off to one side. What they tell us is the two outside fingers act like thumbs because, one, they have more of a sideways articulation to them and can bend them down to act like two thumbs that bend in like this.
Okay.
So two fingers up, two thumbs that bend in like this. Officially, they're all fingers for them. That's what they tell us. So we know that here they have a great deal of agility and speed and strength compared to us. They're faster than we are. They're stronger on average. So if and you're looking at somebody who's about the size of an 8 to 10-year-old child.
Wow.
Uh-huh. They're not real big. But people ask us, have we seen them physically with our own eyes? Or is it just all telepathic, long distance stuff? No, they've been here to our house.
That's interesting because you sometimes think of when a being is more evolved, millions of years or ahead of us, like the grays or whatever, you wouldn't consider them to be stronger. It seems like normally it goes more mental and more kind of thing, and the physical part, not as much. So that's right. Interesting.
And so I don't know if it's a part of their metabolism, their ATP Krebs cycle that generates energy within a cell, their muscle, and maybe it's a factor of the density or gravity on their world. Maybe they have more to overcome there, and our gravity is a little bit lighter here than home, which would make them more buoyant like we are when we go to the moon. So that's a possibility. We don't have all the answers. We just have lots and lots of dialogue time with them, and we've learned so much. It's not even funny. But the Ponte tell us that there are a number of races that are mistaken for one another, that have larger heads, grayer, taupier skin tone, less rosy than ours is, large dark eyes with nictitating lenses over them and fewer fingers. Those races that get confused for one another and all lumped into the category of grays are actually separate nations, oftentimes from very separate parts of our galaxy. And so we are constantly hearing them educate folks as to that don't lump everything all into one category. Just like if you went to visit another world and somebody took your daily habits and actions and manner of speaking as everybody on earth must speak the same way that this person does, that you do. Well, that wouldn't be true. And so we tend to want to lump things together instead of investigate and see them as separate entities.
Okay.
He forgot how sensitive our microphone is, and he was pouring ice into a great big...
Yeah, that sounded like an avalanche.
Yep, it did sound like an avalanche, didn't it? So my apologies.
Did you want to see... I want to go way more into the Ponte.
But
did you want to see that picture that Daryl took?
Oh, I would love to.
He took it, and I don't even know if he knew RE's name. And he said, RE is standing right with you. And I'm not even sure he knew what RE's name was, but... let me show you this.
Yeah.
Hopefully, I mean, you're sensitive. You'll be able to see it.
Oh, yeah.
I believe. Sam?
Oh, yes. All right. So I automatically know to look for that which is, looks like it has a slight fog.
Yeah.
Or smoke over the top of it. That image of slight, the edge of the fog is what, when I look at things like this, I start outlining and looking for the differences in the nuances of the gray within the fog that I'm seeing.
Yeah.
And, oh, yeah, very clearly. Wow, yeah, big guy.
Yeah, Daryl, he's going all around, he takes all these pictures and he's snapping them every left, right, and center. And he took this and he showed me and said, there's RE with you. And you know what? I could feel him with me when he was saying that. I was actually in tears with the energy or whatever, especially when he said he's with you.
Mm-hmm.
So,
He certainly was.
Yeah.
Good picture.
Is Otter there?
Otter is in the kitchen at the moment, retrieving something so that he doesn't cough so much, and he'll be right back out.
I wanted to show you guys quickly the picture of this orb thing. This will blow your mind.
What you got?
Hold on a second.
Yeah.
And let me bring it up first.
Find it first. We have, Darrell is a good friend of ours and will sometimes come spend some time with us just for other talk that's stimulating to him and at that same level. Sometimes when you get into the expertise of an area like he has, you don't want to start at square one and explain to people what you're doing on an everyday basis. You like to be able to, oh, nice picture. Wow. Look at the orbs. Nice, nice, nice. So this, wow.
The smoke is a being too.
Yes,
I've gone over this before. I wanted Otter to see this. Is he around?
Yeah, he's coming back in.
Come on, Otter.
In just a moment. Otter, he wants you to see this, hon. Wow.
So,
yep.
I've gone over this story before a few times on the show, so I don't want to do all the detail, but just to set this up, like I said, my wife and I, we were taking the pictures, and at first it was just a couple.
Where's Beans one?
There was just a couple little orbs. Next picture, there was more. The next picture, there was more. And then this one is when it started forming into this bean, right?
Look at
the face. Can you see the face there?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I see a couple of them starting there.
Yeah.
But yes, so anyway, I certainly do.
This is where, when I was looking at this, I got the knowing, like this amazing being is bringing its consciousness in from all different points of consciousness. We weren't smoking. I don't smoke, for one thing. And there was no fire. So this is just all natural stuff, right? And then the next picture, taking a few seconds, it was walking off, right?
All right.
Yeah.
Sounds like looks like you got somebody with an elbow crossing their arms in front of them like this.
Yeah. And then quickly, look at this face.
Wow.
That's like a female face. Nose, eyes.
Mouth. Yeah, it sure is.
Yeah. Anyway, enough of that.
Neat. But
isn't that neat?
Yeah. Good capture.
So what? Okay, so let's get back to. Oh, and I actually had the question of the ancients and whatever too, but maybe we should stick with the Ponte or instead of jumping around.
Stick
we
with can the jump around because I think that, I think she, you know, it's important this whole idea of the marriage between the Sasquatch people and the.
Well, actually, people, and
that they're teaching human beings. They're both teaching human beings how to mind speak because the Sasquatch people are teaching a lot of people how to mind speak. They just do it kind of naturally, though.
Actually, let me get this Sasquatch question in quickly, okay?
Okay.
Because then we can really get into the Ponte and then go back to the Sasquatch again.
Sure.
So what is the difference between the ancient ones and the regular people or whatever? I mean, the ancient ones can look for thousands of years, right? Can you and they tend to look more human? Can you give us a
all right? So my understanding of the ancient ones is, first of all, we are normally dealing with somebody taller than 8 to 9 feet. They don't have to be a lot taller, but usually they are at least a head taller. In my understanding, that may not be a hard and fast rule, but it seems to be kind of average.
15 feet or above.
12 to 15.
Yeah.
When I think of the ancients too, the one common thing I'm hearing from researchers in a number of continents is the conical head shape instead of the round head shape is much more common. And then also the hair on the face of at least of the males tends to come down to here. You see more skin here and here on the face versus hair all the way up to
and
say
forehead.
The eyeballs.
Yeah, forehead.
Yes, and less hair on the forehead, but more sparse hair. You will see a definite hairline like you and I have, like this on ancients. It's not necessarily a hard and fast rule that the hair on their heads gets longer like ours does than the hair on, say, their arms. But we do see ancients that have longer hair on their heads and in their beard area and the sides of the mustache than we do the rounder-headed species or subspecies of Sasquatch. We typically see the taller conical-headed shaped folks teaching groups of the more round-headed folks. At least that's the assumption that researchers who find both in their same area have talked about. And we've seen some evidence of that in the northern part of Appalachia around Pennsylvania, Ohio, over into Virginia. West Virginia.
Kentucky.
And so we do see and hear stories of this one big guy is in charge of all these other little guys, or is over them, or teaching them, or somehow. We see more evidence that the ancients are the ones hopping a ride on to craft the travel between the stars than the round-headed folks. And again, not a hard and fast rule, but more common do we see the conical-headed folks seem to be wiser, gentler, slower to anger, more apt to get a hold of you telepathically and set you down or put you back in your car and get you driving back down the road than to, say, chuck a stone at you or throw a log at you. They will use their telepathic ability to say, you're not doing something I like in my forest, go back home, and make you do that. And so we see the ancient ability to get a hold of an Earth human and control their actions more than the round-headed or not ancient folks.
What's their role? What's their role? Are they
teachers? Teachers,
yeah.
Spiritual leaders. Mm-hmm. I think you kind of look at the indigenous First Nation people, and you see that they have their medicine men and they have their holy men,
right,
and so on. throughout the clan of that tribe.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very similar as to what's going on here.
Yeah.
With the conical heads and the round-headed Sasquatch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's no question they're teachers. I mean, mm-hmm. that's yeah. why they're reaching out to people with an open, who are heart-centered and are open to learning.
It remind me of monks.
Yeah.
Yeah, monks, priests, rabbis.
Knowledgeable, contrite, heartfelt, honest, open people.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Trying to live a spiritual lifestyle.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How about walk life?
A spiritual life. Yeah.
Walk a spiritual path. There you go.
How about life expectancy? The regular guys, I guess, have a life span maybe similar to ours, and the ancients can live thousands of years, right?
My understanding is that with decent health and no severe injury or illness, that most of the Sasquatch we see, at least in the Rocky Mountain area, can get up to 125, 130, so longer than we have. But the ancients, I have not heard a consistent upper number.
No.
That I can talk about, I would say well above 150 years, but how much above? There's a big difference between 10,000 and 175.
Yeah.
So I would have to get information directly from them. And to be honest, I've never asked an ancient.
No.
But when we were talking, and we'll bring our Reese picture up after we get swing back to the Pontee and whatever again. Because I want to hear the experience too, because it sounds like it was pretty fun that you had. But we'll get into that in a bit. But didn't you say, you told me a few days ago that Arvi is really, really ancient? Like he's really older than
he comes across as an ancient. And part of that is I suspect that his white hair is not albinoism.
It's age.
Is age. Mm-hmm. I suspect he was blonde brown as he was growing and turned this color. Just like as a great ape gets older, they get to be a silverback.
Mm-hmm.
I think that form of going snow white hair like yours or mine is likely due to their age. And my guess is well above 150. I don't know. You'd have to ask Ari how old they get to be with good health. That's a really great question that I don't have the answer to. And I don't know if, like our Pontee friends, if that answer varies depending on, is this their home world?
Yeah.
When the Pontee travel to another planet and spend a great deal of time on another world, their physical bodies take the brunt of the differences between their own home planet and the new world that they're being on, either to explore, to colonize, whatever, because the gravity is different. The geomagnetics are different. The influences and the protection from cosmic rays are different. The water may have a different content. The nutrients in the soil may or may not have what they need for their own health. And so if you add it up, all of these things affect our physical bodies over time. Just like if you were to spend 6 months to a year on the space station, you pay for it physically later. Your eyesight goes to hell in a handbasket. And your physical body structure gets affected. And we're seeing that in astronauts that are dealing with the no gravity in space, affecting how their health is for years afterwards, even though it was just maybe 6 months to a year there. And they need extensive physical therapy after they get home. They don't tell you that very often, but they do. Well, and so our extraterrestrial neighbors and friends deal with that same issue when they come here for any kind of an extended period of time. Unless they can control the environmental gravity, atmosphere, magnetics, within whatever facility underground they colonize here. If they can control those things, then they've got a chance of adjusting easier. But this is not an easy world to adjust to.
So let's swing back to the point again. So what is, I wanted to ask you a couple of questions. Well, actually, three, but I don't want to ask them all at the same time. So what is their lifespan?
They average, they tell us 400 years. Wow. 450 with very good health. But the Ponte that volunteer to come spend more than 20 years here on planet helping find that their lifespans are shortened considerably. You can almost take off a year on average for every 5 years they spend here at the very minimum. And sometimes it's a year for a year. So if you're going to spend 20 years on Earth, you might as well chop 20 years off on average, because that's the physical toll on your body. Again, if you cannot control the environmental niche that you work and play in.
And where did they originally come from? Or are they native to here? And what is their spiritual perspective? Do they believe in reincarnation and that we're eternal beings and all that stuff? Can you get into that a little bit?
Let's start with the last question. Yes, what they say is everything in the universe recycles in some fashion. And that also means us going through physical body after physical body after physical body by choice to learn whatever it is that we want to learn with the hardships that come with being in a physical body. So do they believe in reincarnation? Yes, they do. We're recycled souls that in another body yet. The Ponte control their environmental habitats here enough that it moderates some of the hardship on them physically. But still, they're away from home and not eating the foods that they grew up with. And that makes a difference.
Where is their home?
Where are they from? The Ponte have facilities and colonies in a number of places in this area of the galaxy, the Orion Arm and the Sagittarius Arms of our galaxy. You can find them. They have pointed out on maps a number of places, two up in the around the Pleiades cluster, four or five locations not very far from the Reticuli constellation. And then if you go over to the toe of Orion, it's the constellation, I think, of the rabbit. There's another group of them over in that area. So we're talking about Ponte nations or colonies that have either inhabited worlds or have orbiting stations around a star, or it's one of the worlds that's old enough to them that they consider it like a second home away from home planet.
Okay. Some of these star nations, like their fourth, fifth, and higher dimension, what dimension would they be beyond?
Because they most of the time reside in physical bodies just like ours.
Yeah.
We consider them dimensionally like us, with slightly greater innate abilities than what we're practiced at or taught as children. And so can they do more things than we can do? Yes. We talked about the effect of different gravities on strengths and lifespan and things like that. Somebody asked us, can they just plain walk through walls? They use a technical assist to do that most of the time that's either worn on their person or comes from a craft that they've arrived in. But that ability only goes so far, because if you, let's say, were deep, deep underground 2 miles, can they come that entire 2 miles and walk through solid rock for 2 miles to get to you? Not without help, not without mechanical help. Can they do it? Probably with specialized equipment.
Yeah.
But most of the time we're seeing them essentially dissolving a single wall going from outside to inside instead of multiple layers of rock strata of varying content. And believe it or not, most of the time when they come visit us in our homes, they look for the bathroom for two reasons. One, not because they want to use it. I've asked that before. Did they use the facilities wherever they go? No.
Hey, where's the can?
To find a bathroom in a North American home is easy. You follow the plumbing.
Right.
It is the one room in the house that is almost universally avoided unless you have a need to go there. So if you have a need to shower, a need to put on makeup, a need to use the toilet, then you go into the bathroom, you do your thing, and you get out just about as fast as you can. Most of the time, those rooms are fairly secluded, oftentimes with the doors closed because keeps varying smells inside. And
people strike a match.
Yeah, people don't enter unless they need to. So the privacy issue is solved most of the time. If they go, is anybody down in their bathroom? Good. Let's pop into the tub. And they can dissolve a wall very easily. We kid them about things like that, but when they talk about things that they find in our bathrooms to us, they're all kinds of curious, because every culture has its own things that it grooms itself with. Ours culture is no different. So hairbrushes, makeup, toothbrushes, shaving stuff. We've had all kinds of questions about the routines and rituals that we do, and had to describe to them as, this is what we do on a normal everyday basis. This is something we might do once a week or once a month. You know, you don't necessarily clip your toenails every day, but you have toenail clippers, and what would you use them for? So explaining cultural, ordinary, everyday routines is something that we find ourselves doing a lot of to the Ponte, because honestly, they're cultural explorers. They want to learn about us as a people. They want to learn about our loves and our hates, our favorite music, our foods, our dance, our greetings, our language, our literature.
Yeah.
Those are the things that they find fascinating and that they find can overlap and they can merge with their own culture easier than, say, something scientific. We're not nearly as advanced as they are scientifically. So that aspect, we have more desire to learn about their science. They sometimes will ask us science questions to understand at what lower level we're up to yet, because we're still working at stuff.
Yeah.
But
well, their way to, like, because I've always thought, you know, with RE and Sasquatch, of his abilities or whatever, wherever they want to go, it's just a thought away.
Right.
Yeah. So it's not quite the same with them.
Not quite. Are there energy workers within their culture that can do fabulous things? Yes. Is it every one of them? No. No. Just like, are there fabulous healers in our culture? Yes. Is it every one of us? No.
Yeah.
So everybody has a specialty area that they're drawn to learn about. And others are individuals that love to teach. We found a number of teachers of various kinds. Let me give you, for instance, they have a person on their staff that is a specialist in
both music and tonal languages. And a tonal language is like a bird song. That's a language. Or whale song. That's a language. But tonal languages are variation in pitch and timing and chorus and harmony. And all of that is like we use specific words, phrases, sentences, nicknames, that kind of thing. When we first met the Ponte, they were still a treaty that they signed 50 years ago in 1971. And the treaty that they signed back then, they refer to as the Desert Accord. And it took place in a desert environment that was not North America. We suspect it was the Middle East, but we don't have a specific location as to where it was. We know that a number of individuals from other countries were at that meeting who were Earth human, along with a grouping of star nations. And the treaty was at the request of the Earth humans present and asked for 50 more years to help get us ready to meet them. And so they agreed to not provide photographs, video, or tech to the general population. That treaty ended in August, but when it was still on, the fellow that we first met, Tilcombe, told us that he could not give us photos or video of himself at that point in time because there was a signed agreement. But he said, there is absolutely nothing that stops someone that we contact from drawing their own experience. So you could draw us. That would be fine.
And we're going to get into some of those pictures in a bit.
It's how we got around the treaty.
Yeah. So talk about their personality. What are they like? What are they like? Are they funny? Are they?
The Ponte are hilarious. Their humor is very similar to ours, very similar to the Sasquatches. They love a good tease. They love things that have more than one meaning. Double entendres.
Yes.
Oh, my God. They love teasing. They love practical jokes. And in general, they have been extremely interested in learning our humor because they see it as a cultural overlap with us. And so if we tell them a joke and they don't get it, they want us to explain the whole thing so they finally do get it and can laugh the next time. And so do we see a variety of more mundane and not so funny folks and more artistic folks and more heyoko or hilarious folks? Yeah, you see the entire gamut of personality types amongst the Ponte that you see in our population. Some are more serious and stoic. Others are kind and gentle and loving. Others are very engineer-oriented and tool-oriented. Some are very, very into teaching. And so it just really runs the gamut. And so we've gotten to know a number of these guys from their emotional personality types and their conversation with us, because you never know what they're going to bring up or what they're going to ask next. It's just, it runs the gamut from, does shaving hurt, to, are tattoos a leadership display? Wow. To, what do you do with the hairs in your hairbrush? I mean, we've had all kinds of questions.
Does it hurt to shave?
Yeah.
Yeah, when I cut myself.
So they ask us about the food preparation stuff that we do. They ask us about things that are the rules of our society. And where does it cross from, we don't recommend it, to that's illegal, okay? And everywhere in between. We've had a number of discussions as to polite conversation and words that you do and don't use and why, to when is a little white lie appropriate and when is it not? And they had to understand all of those things about us. And then we talked to them about male speak versus female speak, because women in our society tend to speak more emotionally and look for that empathetic understanding back, whereas men, not so much. And so we've had discussions with them about homosexuality versus heterosexuality versus anything in between. We've had extensive discussions with them about reproduction.
Can I make a point here?
Yeah.
So for them, is there that difference or distinction between the males and the females too? Or, mm-hmm. as far as speak, they're the same way in that way?
Features?
Females are more emotional and more
anatomical.
Telepathically?
No. I mean, like women are more emotional, women are more, is there that distinction with them as well?
I think it runs pretty even.
It's pretty close to even. We do find guys that tend to be more empathetic and gals who tend to be more tool or engineering oriented, well, left brain, so to speak.
For
the most part, we don't find the extremes that we find in our society. Right. If I went back to the kind of archetypes of personalities that we have as Earth humans, we've seen all kinds of writing in the past 50 years of how to understand what kind of an archetype personality type you are. That Briggs-Myers personality test stuff that they talk about in school. But do we see the violent tendencies in them? Not that we've seen here. Do we see the aggressive nature or the territorial nature that you might see another mammal have? No, not so much. Do we see them loyal? Oh, absolutely. Do we see them defending and protecting their friends? Yes, for sure. So there are many things that overlap with their culture and our culture that we recognize as nonverbal things, not all of it.
When you say them protecting their friends, are you talking about you as well?
We're talking about any friends that they make. No, because if it's one of their Sasquatch friends, if they had friends up in the Valles Caldera area and there was a forest fire that was sweeping through that area, they would be there to help.
Get them out.
Immediately. Yeah. If we had a problem, if Otter and I had a problem, would they be here for us? Yeah, we've become their very good friends.
Cool.
They used the analogy of they described a desperate situation and used an analogy like this. First of all, one of the reasons they're trying to make more contact now is things in our star are changing. Things in our solar system are changing right now. And we are entering into an area of our galaxy that is very unkind to stars and planets magnetically. And danger-wise to us, the area that we're entering into in this part of the galaxy has a bad history of getting our star, our sun, to sneeze violently and expel an awful lot of material, plasma, coronal mass ejection. Some people say that it can sneeze violently enough, you would call it a micronova. That, if that were to happen, our civilization would restart again. Just plain and simple. It's not that it would just take out our satellites. It would take out our magnetosphere. What is that? That's what keeps us safe from cosmic rays.
That's what keeps us grounded. We would have
to
go
underground to be safe.
Maybe.
Likely. Anyway, they tell us that our planet is about to go through what we call a Malevahest. Okay, it's just one big Malevahest. And we can't avoid it. We can't stop it. They can't stop it. But they can come to help keep us safe if need be. And then they went into an analogy. And the analogy that they used was this. If you know there's a really, really bad storm and a tornado hits the town where your best friend lives, the very next day, if you know a tornado has been through your best friend's town and you want to help, where's the first place you go? You go see if your friend is okay and if you need to help him.
Yeah.
Right? That's your instinct. Let me go to where my friend lives. Of all the places in that town that got leveled, where would you try and get to? You would try to get to your friend.
Right.
They do the same thing. If you make friends with a star nation here, when the proverbial stuff hits the fan with our star,
we may have a chance of getting out of it.
You have people that would come check on their friends first. And that's one of the reasons that we say making friends with star nations now is really important. They want to see our cultures, plural, to continue. They consider themselves gardeners of intellect. That's what they refer to.
Gardeners of intellect.
Yes, gardeners
of intellect. That's their mission.
That's their mission here.
What does that mean to you?
Well, all right. If you're a gardener, you plant a seed where you think it's going to grow the best, right? You give that seed, that plant, what it needs to become the best, whatever it can be, whether that's a tomato plant or a zinnia. As a gardener of intellect, they see a culture that's just getting started in the right place, but it needs some help to become the very best it can be. And so when societies go through this area of the galaxy and whole planets get bumped back to zero again and have to restart, those star nations who come to help with everything from teaching medicine, agriculture,
sciences,
astronomy, just the basics of how do you get potable water? How do you build? What do you do? What are the things that keep a society together in a healthy way where they're not killing each other off? How do you get a culture to restart? And so that's what they have studied for centuries, millennia, is not just Earth, but planet after planet after planet. They like to study a culture, see how it's doing, and see if there's anything they can do to help. They consider that a worthwhile way to live as their culture to help others.
Wouldn't that be
and
nice?
So that's what they travel the galaxy to do, and that's just the Ponti.
No.
They are considered neutral amongst all the star nations that visit Earth. They're like Switzerland. It's neutral.
They have an ambassador seat on a council on the moon, too.
So
let me ask, and I don't want Beans to get in there and ask some stuff too, but I just got
he had an ambassador seat? Who said that?
What did you say, Otter?
I said the Ponti have an ambassador seat on the Federation meetings and on the moon.
Oh, true. We have a number of star nations that have joined forces to keep things going in a right-minded way in this area of the galaxy so that their star nation doesn't come in to an emerging culture. That's what they consider us. We are an emerging culture because we are just emerging onto the interstellar scene. We have just left our own atmosphere, just started to explore. That's why we are an emerging culture. But they don't want us at this delicate stage to be taking
advantage of by a greedy culture out there. And so they have put Earth into what they call a protected planet status.
I was going to ask you.
So nobody can come to Earth and enslave us.
Just a couple months ago, four of the Earth's, nations who can get into outer space. You know, there's the U.S. Mm-hmm. military, and then the Dark Fleet, and then there's I forget. There's a couple other ones. There's the
Chinese have ships up there and a space station.
And Antarctica people, they have fleet. But anyway, they had this Jupiter Accord, and the Jupiter Accord just was like 2 or 3 months ago, where they all got together to the Galactic Federation of Nations of whatever it is, and they just signed this kind of a peace pact, and America is kind of going to be the umbrella for manufacturing stuff like the med beds and future fleets and organizing things. But you know, Japan and China, Russia, France. They're all in on it. Yeah.
And
in terms of taking people off the planet, I started off at the beginning of this talk talking about the people who investigate the UFOs, right? And then the people mm-hmm. who investigate the Sasquatch people. Well, the people who investigate the UFOs got this thing pretty much dialed in, and that is that in North America, they've been around 2% of the population has already been taken on craft, got physicals or whatever. And 80% of them get an upgrade. That's the thing that's really important, is 80% of the people who connect with the Star Nations, they get an upgrade physically, spiritually, emotionally.
Exactly.
It's the same with Sasquatch. Mm-hmm. If you're connected to Sasquatch, you're going to get upgraded spiritually, emotionally, physically, worldview, connecting to Mother Earth. So, in North America, that would equate to 2% is about 7 million people. And you could figure maybe another 10 million people in South America, because they're more active down there. And then another 6 or 7 million people. They're already connected to the Star Nation people. And mm-hmm. I think are going to be under that umbrella. So there's that. This is a much bigger issue. Then the Sasquatch people are just looking at the Sasquatch people, and the UFO people are just looking at but it's a much bigger issue than people. If you don't make that bridge, you're missing half the story.
Extraordinary craft. transmit thought energy far beyond the norm. You close your eyes, you concentrate, together that's the way to send the message we declare.
I heard something years ago from a man that I thought was extremely profound as a spiritual walking man. And he said, if you do not walk with one foot in today and one foot in the spiritual world, you're not in contact. You have to be in contact with both sides. The reality world of today and the spiritual world of yesterday, today, and the future.
Yeah. We call it walking with a foot in each world. You know, the pay your bills world.
I agree.
New laundry.
The downside of that is we have been at war for like five. Well, you talk about this. We're the fifth root race, right? The fourth root race, right? We're involved to this level. We've been at war with the same beings for those four, at least three of the four epochs the human beings have been through. And they were in a temporal war with us. They would plan their shots out hundreds and a thousand years at a time. In time, they knew if they did something like the Spanish Inquisition and tortured a bunch of women, that's going to make everybody afraid of being psychic and doing any healing or being witches or whatever. Right? That went on for 400 years, and that's been, and it's impacted us now for 500 years. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's temporal war kind of stuff. Those guys are seeing, because the people who are in control of the people who are in control, they're you know, not stuck in time the way we are. So that's why we've never been able to win until now.
Yeah. So I was going to ask you. Mm-hmm. My question was, but you kind of answered it with what the Pontee are doing here now. You kind of already answered my question, and you know, I mean, we all have our own ideas on it. When I ask you a question, doesn't mean we don't know or have our own thoughts, but you know, you're the host, right? So what do you think? I mean, you're the guest. Why do you think, if you're saying the Pontee, I was going,
well, we're wondering who's running the show and who's not.
So I was going to say, why do you think, but you kind of answered my question, but I'll still phrase it. Why do you think that we at this time in our history, like we are being contacted by Sasquatch, so many Star Nations people, the Pontee, whatever. And I think you basically answered, I'm getting energy, basically answered it with the Pont, because it's because we're going through a shift. They're very concerned. It's very crucial. And they're kind of there to guide us and whatever. Is that what you say?
That's a good part of the urgency of now. Why now? I mean, why are they here? Right. We asked them that, and basically they said it's because you're a water world, and where there's water, there's life. But why now? Because they were here the last time our world went through this part of the galaxy and saw the reset that happened at the end of the last ice age. And we're about ready, 13,000 years ago. We're about ready to go through that kind of extreme weather pattern again. And we're seeing the beginnings of it now. I mean, if you think back to the weather when we were kids and compare it to the extremes that you're seeing now, we no longer have a hurricane season. It's all year round. We no longer have a tornado season. We just had devastating tornadoes in December, and we've got tornadoes predicted for next week. In Chang, never used to happen. The extremeness of the wind patterns that we're seeing now, I just heard on the news yesterday that they are predicting, or were predicting again for Colorado, wind gusts between 90 and 125 miles an hour.
In the mountains.
You should see Boulder right now. They leveled the fire that went through that area with the high winds, leveled 1,000 homes. Yep. We are seeing flooding in Florida.
Sunny day flooding. Yeah.
Sunny day flooding. What the heck is that? Well, that's our planet changing. And they're finally not poo-pooing the meteorologists who are talking about climate change. But they're still arguing as to who caused it and who's going to pay for it.
I mean,
they're not doing anything to keep us safe.
They
are doing something. They're raising our property, insurance on the property now. They that's what they're doing.
But are they not here because we're at a very crucial time where we could either like go extinct or wake up and whatever? I mean, there's a lot. It's more than just weather.
That's right.
Absolutely.
It's more than just weather, because our world has a strong possibility that many species, not just us, but many species may face an extinction level event if our sun sneezes in a micronova type fashion and it hits our planet. Is that a guarantee? No, it's not a guarantee, but we know that this area of the galaxy has a nasty reputation, just like you know if a storm system has the potential to form a tornado. You don't know exactly if it's going to for sure, or where or when, days ahead of time, but you can see the patterns setting up, and you want to be ready just in case. The Ponte and the other star nations who've been visiting our planet for eons are just as much risk, many of them, as we are if that kind of an event happens.
Right.
And so, again, the folks like the Ponte that are cultural explorers have a lot vested, not only in research here, but also friends and caring and history and development and sharing, and want to introduce themselves as our friendly neighbors and relatives instead of monsters, instead of E.T. is going to come eat you or enslave you or kill you. The vast, vast, vast majority of interstellar species who come to our planet are good people. They're right-minded people. How do we know? Because we're having this conversation, because we are not slaves, because we are free to talk.
And there's a lot of them. There's a lot of them. You know, like I said, I've listened to insiders, and they say there's about 20 star nations that are permanently close around Earth, helping it all the time. But there's over 2,000 star nations that just drive by and see what's going on, and you know, because they're out exploring the galaxy, 2,000 a year.
Yeah.
And we've got 20 star nations that are actually involved in one form or another of helping out or protecting, or
those are the terrestrial ones, not the aquatic ones.
Yeah.
75% of the star nations that visit our planet are here to go into our oceans, not for us.
Right.
Not for us. Yeah. We're a water world, guys. They want to go talk to our whales. They want to go talk to the sentient aquatics that live in the deep oceans that we think are nothing. And we, at any given day, the Ponte tell us that between 75 and 80 separate star nations are on this world.
Yeah.
But most of them we never see, because
I think this is important information, because again, it's the blinders, you know. It's just, you know, ghosts, or it's just ETs, or it's just, it's the whole thing. The whole
thing. All interconnected.
Yep. You think like we do. We, had been talking to the Ponte for 3 years when they sent us a telepathy teacher who then dictated the Telepathy 101 primer that we helped them publish on their website. And that individual, her name is Tini, she helped us understand a great deal about the importance of teaching this, so that we get our brains used to that telepathic contact. It's more than just hearing words like you hear from a radio. It's emotions, it's images, it's history, it's other people's other connections with other telepathic nations. It's the intensity of the situation. You get all of that simultaneously when you get a telepathic download from them. And it's tiring on our brains because we're not used to that level
of emotions
and strength of sending or emotions. And so we have to help our brains get used to it by practicing. All right. It's kind of like, if I want to build a bicep, I gotta work my arm muscle and gradually keep increasing things until I can get a bicep. Our brains are similar in the need to practice so that we can have longer and longer conversations with them. It's just a lot, but many, I would have to say a majority, not all, but a majority of the nations that come here are telepathic in one shape or form. You have to remember, not every star nation that visits our world, not all of them are at the same level of technology. Some of them are just beyond us.
Some of them are interested only in minerals, you know. So
that's right. You know. And so we tend to want to lump all ETs into one category, and you can't do that any more than you can lump all people who happen to go to the same university as, well, obviously they're all the same. They must have grown up in the same place or must all be alike. No, not even. Mm-hmm. They come from all different walks of life, all different cultures, all different kinds of growing up. And they reminded us that if you meet one individual from a star nation, please don't judge the entire nation by the actions of one individual. It's just one person. You cannot assume.
There's another layer here I wanted to toss out, and that is that the news from the whole thing about the star people coming here is like, and you mentioned that treaty that was a 50-year treaty that they can't be seen, or they can't, you know, they can't come and take up residence here. The star nations want to have full open contact with humanity. They want to have bases here. They want to have bases here. They want to have universities here. They want to have medical training facilities here. They want to have healing facilities here.
Yes.
And in order to do that, that means there's going to be infrastructure that has to be made. There has to be bank accounts set up. And in order to do all that, and there has to be money transferred, all this kind of stuff.
Trade agreements.
In order to do that, they need people who can talk to them.
That's right.
Interpreters.
That's right.
Interpreters. So exactly. All these people who are you know, and it's not just going to be one ET, you know, it's like there may be six or seven different ETs are going to be into a manufacturing consortium to build whatever, med beds or to build spacecraft mm-hmm. or whatever, right? So mm-hmm. then those people who are the interpreters, they need to have mind speak so they can talk to the developers, the bulldozer guys, the construction guys, the road builder guys to get all their infrastructure made. That's pretty much the way it's going to have to go. There'll have that's to be right. a certain class of people who are going to be the interpreters.
That's right. That's right. In everyday foundation level stuff. Uh-huh. And mostly it's just, let me understand your concept of money. Let's take the topic. And here's our concept of money or exchange. How can we take your concept and our concept and come to a trade agreement? That's not always easy when you don't know anything about somebody's home planet.
It's nothing. Called bartering.
Mm-hmm. And so you're right. The regular old everyday foundation level workers, the guys that run the construction job, the people that design educational systems, the interpreters that can translate, you use these ingredients to cook that dish. Gee, what are my equivalents? All of those and everything else is going to be required, but it first is going to require somebody whose brain has the capacity to sustain the longer conversations and deal with it accurately.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely
right.
Who can
be trusted?
Yes, who are not in it for their own gain. That's the hard part. And folks,
their heart's got to be in it.
They've got to have worked on themselves enough to be right-minded.
Oh yeah.
Listen, all these people, all these groups, they have advanced spiritual souls, right? Almost every group out there has another layer.
Everyone is visiting here.
Spiritual masters, right? So every group has their own, you know, as ascended masters, and those guys are willing to come and make up your spiritual schools, spiritual ashrams, kind of things to,
sure.
you know, to elevate all of humanity, whoever wants to go. I mean, for that. You need, you know, whatever it is, stadiums or, you know, classrooms or something.
Yeah.
You do, and it has to be a place where everybody feels safe. And that's key also, because we have a whole bunch of people who follow our Ponte friends on Twitter and Facebook, who if they got a chance.
How many do you think that is? It's like a couple hundred thousand or something, isn't it? 50,000?
There, we have at least that follow the information from the Ponte on Twitter. There's at least 17,500 subscribers right now. The Facebook account is a private group for friends of the Ponte and who have studied the things that they have presented since starting their Twitter account back in 2015. They came to USC. The Tilkham and Radar, another fellow over there, both came to us and said, we understand Earth has something called social media where we can teach people across the world instantly for free. Is this correct? Can we have an account? And they asked us to open accounts for them so that they could begin teaching. And for the first 2 years, translating for them, Otter and I remained completely anonymous. And we found that we had enough information and questions about the how-to and the discussion behind the scenes that we had to, as people who have talked to the Ponte extensively since 2013, had to answer as ourselves, as the translators. And that's the only reason that we let our names go out there onto the Twitter account, because we wanted it to be for the Ponte to teach. That was their whole sole purpose, is to share information.
Yeah, well, Rita Shurtick, she's got your whole thing. She said she downloaded the whole book, the whole protocol, and she said it took her a whole thing of ink, mm-hmm. you know, from her ink cartridge. And then there's some yeah. there's another guy who his name is Hal Jerome Indick. I think he knows the Ponte too. And
Hal is also at the Sasquatch conference. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. Hal has been here to our house.
Yeah.
And he's a videographer and documentary maker.
Yeah.
And he's done documentaries on the Sasquatch with people who have interacted with them personally. Yeah. We only understood about the Sasquatch because after Tani had dictated the Telepathy 101 primer, they wanted us to go teach that very beginning manual before it went out onto the internet to make sure that we'd worked all the bugs out of it. And we said, sure, where do you want us to go? They spelled out the Sasquatch researcher's name for us and asked us to look him up, please. And when they did that, they spelled out Kiwani Lapsaritis.
Oh, yeah. How about that?
He did. I mean, that's not a name that you make up the spelling for. They were very exact. And when we contacted them, it was the day after the announcement of the first Sasquatch conference that they were putting on wow. up in Chihuahua.
Yeah.
So the very next day.
That, didn't you? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So we got in on that.
That's conference. The one we froze our butts on.
Oh, we learned how to get warm real fast. That conference, we went and taught the Telepathy 101 primer the very last day of the conference, the very last thing of the day. And people stayed late to the conference just to get that information. We came back with that information, worked the bugs out, and then published the Telepathy 101 primer with as a PDF format in December of 17. And within 3 months, it was translated into a dozen languages by volunteers. Wow.
Yeah. So let me recap that.
Yeah.
The Ponte, who are extraterrestrial people,
mm-hmm.
got in touch with you and told mm-hmm. you to get in touch with a Sasquatch investigator named Kiwani Lapsaritis, and then he was going to do a convention,
mm-hmm.
and then they wanted you to go to that convention to teach people this 101 thing.
We did. Me,
that is one of the reason why I'm so thrilled to have you both here, because that is the beginning of the marriage between the Sasquatch people and the Sasquatch investigators and the UFO
extraterrestrials.
We have a presentation for that conference that we wrote for the second year, and it's called Sasquatch, ET, and Their Telepathic Connections.
Yep.
And that whole presentation is linked on my YouTube channel. Max Gully was the person who filmed all of the presentations that second year and happened to film us. And so you can see the original presentation we did on Sasquatch, ET, and their telepathic connections. And I think it's also available on the official firstcontact.com website. I think it's linked in. And then if people want to, they can go to my YouTube channel. I think it's linked in there as well. Did I send you a link to that, Brian? Sasquatch ET? I thought so. Is that link going to be in the description if people are interested in seeing it?
I can put all that stuff in the video and whatever. Sure.
Okay. Okay. But that explains the overlap.
Okay. Yeah.
So I wanted to make a comment on, you know, that's what my experience is like every day. Connections, just like you're talking about. They are mm-hmm. constantly connecting as people that they want us to.
Yeah.
Have consider ideas that could change your life or that can enhance our journey. It's always when they're working with you, and I'm like the Ponte, I'm sure the same way, it's connection. That's just the whole thing, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And that was a beautiful story, like you said, about Kiwani Lapsaritis. That's the identical thing. Yeah. I mean, yeah. you know, yeah.
the day after the ad went out, mm-hmm. we had no
idea. So I wanted to ask you. My teaching and my knowing with the Sasquatch people, and I'm sure the Ponte will, I'm sure that's the same thing. Like, we are not going to change by electing a new president or a new political leader or not, this system, that this broken system that we got right now. The only way that we are going to transcend the conscious shift, or whatever you want to call it, and this is a big knowing that they gave me, is, you know, realize we're all connected, no fear, no judgment, heart-centered. And when you make that switch, you cannot be in this crazy, mixed up, back-assward world or whatever. You can't even think these negative things. That's the only way that we are going to transcend and evolve conscious shift, whatever you want to call it, is by taking that lesson to heart and actually doing the work and getting there, like on a higher vibration or whatever you want to say. So, you know, that's not even in question with me. No one's going to tell me any different because I felt it energetically. You know it, right? So what the Ponte and I guess all these Star Nations beings or whatever that are benevolent, they're probably all on board with that, I would imagine.
They are. They do understand the concept of agape love or unconditional love.
Yes.
And that's extremely important to them. They do understand and live by a culture of emotional honesty. All right. And so they are very upfront with what they think and what they feel politely. Whenever you run into a telepathic culture, it's ultra polite. Kind of like if we go from here to Japan, we consider Japanese culture quite polite compared to ours. And so the Ponte is very similar in that fashion. They are very, what they call right-minded, meaning see a need, fill a need, just because it's the right thing to do. Think seven generations into the future of all the consequences of all of your actions.
Man, so
if you're
going to
dump
that.
Your garbage into the ground, is it still going to be there seven generations from now? And are you taking care of the planet and leaving it better than when you found it?
Did you want to look at some of their pictures?
Sure.
We'll get into one of the, and, you know, I don't think this unless, I mean, if you have to have a potty break or something, you know, go for it. But I mean, as far as I'm concerned, this interview could go on for a while. It's really enjoying it. But
How are you doing, Otter? How's you're doing? You got a little bit more time that, okay. He and I poop out frequently about this time of the afternoon and take our afternoon siestas. Depends on
just how early whatever you got to do.
Let's go ahead and look at some things.
But I wanted to ask you, before we get to some of those videos, what do the Ponte eat? What do they like to eat?
They are considered pescatarian, and that means they will eat some fish, but mostly it's fruits and veggies. The fish or the things from the ocean that they eat are not octopus or squids. It is not anything in the cetacean family either. Seaweed is one of their favorite things, especially if it's pickled. And their cabbages, our cabbage they love and will turn into all kinds of things. So anything in the cabbage family, whether it's broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, cabbage, kale, all of those things. They will try many of our things. We don't see them do alcohol. That doesn't tend to agree with their system. But they are very knowledgeable about many of our plants because some of the plants that we see on our world that we have taken as indigenous to Earth alone, they tell us you can find relatives on many worlds. And I said, can you give us a for instance? And he said, well, if it has multiple functions, likely it was brought here. I said, like? They said, well, bamboo. You can eat it. Hearts of palm, coconuts, bamboo, or that family has a lot of uses. Construction, travel, fuel source. So you can even strip down fibers of some of the things and weave them. So it depends on what it is, but things that have multiple uses as food, medicine, clothing, shelter, fuel, that kind of thing. We see that many of those plants have been brought from somewhere else. we see them wanting to try things here, but they prefer, say, natural sweeteners to artificial. They won't do like Diet Coke. They would refuse. But they might try a sip of regular Coke just because it comes with corn syrup and products. Mm. But for the most part, they're more tea people than coffee people. They're more honey versus cane sugar. And they want to learn how we prepare our foods using what kind of tools and utensils. That's of interest because that's a cultural thing. So we find ourselves demonstrating or talking about things like that extensively. A seaweed in many forms, whether it's boiled, baked, layered in a casserole, dehydrated, dried, they'll eat seaweed from here as long as the area of the ocean it's coming from is clean. So they're particular about things as far as the pollution in that part of the world is concerned. They're particular about
maybe one day we'll have off world supermarkets, you know, like we have specialty stores.
They know? Get things delivered from home. In fact, we know that at least at the Sandia Mountain, Thursdays are delivery days here. And it is not completely unusual that we see the mountain shrouded in clouds all day, all night for a good 24 to 48 hours surrounding a Thursday. That's not unusual here at all.
Imagine if we had 20 star nations here and they're all like having their little grocery stores. And
that'd be neat.
And
love to see what they have.
Yeah. Let's get into some of those pictures. But before you guys poop out, because I do want to get into the RE pictures too, because that explains the process of how you channel mm-hmm. them mm-hmm. and how you do that. Because I want to hear that experience. So don't okay. if you're gonna skedaddle, make sure we get that in. But let's bring all up right. some of the okay. But okay. let's bring up some of the Ponte pictures right now. And if you want me to pause or anything, yeah, just let me know, right?
Yep.
So I'm going to put myself on mute just for a second.
All right, you do that, and I'll see if I can help you understand what we're seeing here. All right, so I have to see. Okay, all right. I was wondering which program you had. This particular picture that you see on the cover was a play on the movie Avatar. They had me go through a number of famous science fiction movies and do spoofs on them, but that was where the idea for that picture came from. So when Tilcombe first asked me to draw, I seriously had not drawn anybody since high school, and this was as good as I could do at the moment. So I had a lot of things wrong, and I had a lot of things that I didn't understand what I was seeing, and was still scared to draw because I thought I would mess up and be awful at it. So
you're seeing this, right?
Yep, that was the best I could do. That was the fellow that we first nicknamed Sandia, who is Tilcombe, T-L-K-M, is Commander Tilcombe. He's the manager of the station there.
I'm just playing it through now, so yep. If you want me to pause, yep. let me know.
Yep, will do. So they worked with me. They sent me an art teacher, and she worked with me every day.
Hold on a second. I'm just going to go to some of the pictures.
Yeah, go straight to the pictures. So I started out with using chalk. This is Dell. Hold it right there for a second. Dell is what they call their fleet master because their ships, while they are extruded vessels, are instilled with a consciousness. Their engineer that runs their hangar bay is closer to somebody who takes care of a herd of horses than a mechanic because of the consciousness of the ships. So this is the fella. He's the oldest one at the station. We know that Tilcombe was born in our year 1777. And we know that Dell here is probably 50 years older than that. So we're guessing about 1725.
20 something, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Would be our year that he was born. Go ahead. Okay. Oh, that light above there, that's a floater. It's a floating flashlight. You just carry it in your pocket and hang it in the air wherever you want, leave it there, and it stays. I want one.
Look at this guy.
Yep, that's Dell. Same guy.
Dell again.
Same guy.
Nice.
Age. He lost a daughter here on Earth and as had her die. Depp is one of their trainers. I have better pictures of him now. I don't like this one, but Grayson is their literature and cultural writings expert, and he collects them. He loves our Shakespeare.
He likes Oliver Wendell Holmes, too.
Oh, he does, too, yeah. So, Grayson. T'ping or not T'ping?
Grayspear.
Yeah, that came from his love of Shakespeare.
Wow. T'ping
is their term for contacting somebody telepathically. Jael is their music collector. And she at home played an instrument. And I said, what's it sound like? And she said, the closest thing I have found on Earth is something you call a water phone. I said, show me your instrument that you play on your world. Go to the next picture.
I just wanted to ask you, do they use music for healing and stuff too?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Vibration makes a huge difference in cellular health. Absolutely, it does.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, no, I didn't have her picture. I'll show you another picture of Jael. But she's just easy to talk to. There it is. This is a shell that they retrieve from their deep ocean that has gills in it. See where her fingers are?
Yep.
There are almost gill-like structures there that when you dry it, it becomes hard and pluckable, almost like harp strings. The bottom of it has a cavity that you fill with water. And so you move this whole thing, this whole shell structure around. And in the back part of it, there are times where you can take your finger and pull them back and let them go like a ping, like a pluck. And so this whole thing changes from one side to the other, how you play it. But fascinating discussion on their musical instruments.
You know what I find fascinating is, like you said, that as a rule, they're stronger, physically stronger than us, and yet they look so frail.
They're little. Compared to, well, again, think about a 10-year-old child.
Yeah.
Somewhere between second and fourth grade.
Yeah.
Boy, look at the emotion in that face. Yep. You really know how to capture. You're really good.
I had a good teacher. This was the first gal that we ever met from the station. This is Jeruti. Jeruti asked for her picture to be drawn with a headscarf because that's what she normally is like. She doesn't like her head to be cold, so she keeps it covered. I said, is there a spiritual thing? She said, no, it's a temperature thing. But she did understand that there are cultures on Earth that require their women's heads to be covered with a scarf. And so she thought it was an honoring thing, too.
Wow, look at this picture.
Mm-hmm. Praying for peace. They do pray. They do. Well,
of course. Yes, you know. Why wouldn't they?
And a lot of people ask, do they believe in God? They do. That's also Drudy. That was one of the first images I did on all black paper instead of on white paper. Theodore Dark 30. She just learned that a dear friend of hers had passed away on another world. And we asked him about makeup and what do they look like when they're fancy? Do they put color on their faces?
Wow.
So that's where all that came from. Comma. Just
that looks like a tablet.
It's what they call a glass pad. We have seen them turn on in our living room 4 times now.
Yeah.
No kidding. One of them, it was sitting next to my thigh on the couch. Kit is their dream teaching expert. She teaches and trains other staff members in teaching us while we are in dream state, because it frequently is the easiest, fastest way to instruct us with telepathy is to enter into our dreams and teach us that way.
That picture is phenomenal.
That's
beautiful. That picture is just beautiful. Wow. Wow. So deep.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot to that one. Mim is the art expert who helped me learn how to draw again.
or really draw people, Sasquatch people, Pontee people, for the first time.
Wow.
Some of the Zeta Nations have no cartilage in their nose. The Pontee have a small button nose. Every once in a while, you get somebody with more of a nose ridge, but for the most part, they have just a little cartilage at the end.
This guy looks pretty wise. The head of the
Korean Wall is, yep, he's their second in command. Yep, he's pretty stern and no nonsense.
Yeah.
So he'll answer the tough questions, or he'll take care of on Twitter if we have troll issues. He'll frequently deal with them. But he schedules the visitation of their people to come see us. Mm-hmm. Orth is security assistant, but he's also their records keeper. The people that get visited here on Earth, those of us that get visits, they have extensive files on, oftentimes since you were kids.
Yeah, you know, and I'm noticing, you know, like you were saying earlier, that there are a lot of races that look like grays that are not very similar. Like this guy, I mean, I'm more into the Sasquatch than ETs, but this guy looks kind of like a gray to me.
That's why he requested the nictitating lenses be covering his eyes. Same guy, only dealing with his glass pad and his checklists.
Yeah.
This is what his eyes look like when you retract the lenses. It's a deep amber, brown red mahogany almost.
Yeah. Almost can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
PETA is, I did this image of PETA. PETA is one of their children's visiting people. He goes to visit kids because it takes a whole different mindset to visit a 6-year-old than it does to visit a 26-year-old. And when I did that picture, go back to that for just a second. When I did that first picture of PETA, I drew it. I drew him. He asked for it peeking around a corner. And I said, do you want it to be a tree, a corner of a building, a door? He said, yes. I said, okay. And I had it done. And I was walking away from my easel. And he said, Sue, do you know what an infinity symbol looks like? And I said, sure. He said, could you put one here by my eyes and put the word friendship under it? And that was the last thing that got added to that picture at his request.
You know, I've seen the Sasquatch, a lot of the glyphs and messages I get, I've seen a lot of infinity symbols with them as well.
Mm-hmm. I can believe that. Yeah. I do believe that.
Oh, that's true. Very true.
So Pete is on the cover of our book.
That's
Inviting friendship. E.T. is the cover of the book. Yep. Infinite
friendship. Infinite right. friendship.
That's exactly why he wanted it. So this is Radar Rahaz.
Oh, he looks like a rock and roller.
He was visiting a musician up in Ontario, Canada. And that musician volunteered to teach him to play guitar. He said, held up his hand, he said, 4 fingers. And the guitar teacher was a master guitar teacher, said, let me work on that and see what I can come up with fretwork for you for 4 fingers. And I'll get back to you. 3 days later, he had it, contacted Radar again and said, come on over, I'll teach you to play. True story.
Wow.
Radar cuts up. Yep. He's our goofball. If he can make a joke out of something, he will. He loves hats.
We be jamming, man.
We be jamming, man.
We be jamming, man.
It was Radar who introduced us to Sasquatch culture more than the other Pontee, because in 2001, he met a newborn Sasquatch whose name is Kie, and he's gotten a chance to watch Kie. Kie is now 20. Turned 20 last month.
Yeah.
So Kie and Radar are best buds.
And he no longer fits in a skipper ship.
No, Kie is about the size of your fella.
Yeah.
And so we've learned a lot. You can flip to anything you want to and ask about it. This is Radar again. There's a lot of these. Drudy, Radar, and they did ask...
Wow.
If we learned moonwalking on the moon.
We said, no, not exactly. So we showed them the original Michael Jackson, Billie Jean
video clip. The quality of your artwork. I mean, wow. It's you're just phenomenal.
I have learned a lot. In fact, now I'm doing more than just faces. Used to be I was just doing Sasquatch faces along with Ponte faces, and now I'm doing a lot more action shots and full body work.
We want to get into some of the Sasquatch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Too. Yep. Do you want to keep going with this?
Yeah, let's go bring up the Sasquatch kids. That'll be a fun one to go through.
Okay.
I like that one.
And we still got to talk about the experience with RE and how that process works.
We can segue
from that.
Yep, we'll do that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep. So that's the sampling.
Let me go find the Sasquatch kids ones. They're a little.
Yeah. They're fun and it's short.
Well, yeah, they're shorter, but I mean, it's not. I could have watched that. You know, we could have watched that all day. That's amazing.
All of these are available for people to see on my YouTube channel. So the Sasquatch portraits, the Ponte portraits, other information that the Ponte have given us, all are available on my YouTube channel. And just Sue Walker, just do not put an E on Sue. And look it up and you'll find picture with this lady with white hair. That'd be me.
If people want to ask you to do a portrait of their Sasquatch friend,
they can write to me. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Uh-huh. And you can do that. You can get a psychic image of them so you can actually do the work. But I think that's real important because there's a lot of people who would like to have a picture of their Sasquatch friends that they don't really.
Yep. Be happy to do that.
That's what we're going to talk about.
I've never seen my Sasquatch people because they wanted to teach me invisibly and non-verbally.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
That's kind of how they prefer to do it. But
well, that's what we're going to do.
A lot of people are,
We'll talk about doing that, and I'll show you some examples.
That's what we're going to do when we get into the RE picture. You're going to run through how he was working with you, right?
Mm-hmm. We sure will.
So that'll kind of explain that, and plus I really want to hear what, because I'm sure he probably made, you know, whatever. I'm sure you've got some funny stuff to share because I know what he's like. But okay, let's get into these little Sasquatch kids.
The Sasquatch came to me after the first Sasquatch conference. Our local clan leader came and he said, will you please draw us as we see each other, not as monsters?
Here we go.
I said, you send me anybody you want. Yep, go ahead and hit it.
Then you want to pause at any time or
you can probably let it scroll. And if there's one that we need to pause, I'll show you. But this is just we tried to catch the kids as they naturally were.
Oh,
blow it up there, Brian.
What?
Blow
Make
it up.
Full screen.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Sorry, guys.
That's right.
There you go.
That's better.
Look at that one.
Behind. So. You'll see all the short hair, the long hair, the red, the brown, the black, the white.
Oh, my God. That one's priceless.
He was not quite one.
That's a baby, huh?
Huh?
A baby.
He was not quite one.
I cannot express or mention, I know I've mentioned it 10 times, but my God, look at the emotion in that face. That is, you are so talented.
I had good teachers, and I asked them, all of these guys, either their parents or they themselves chose their pose, or I suggested some ideas for them and then they picked.
This speaks to the diversity of their faces because this guy looks more ape-like. Whatever, right?
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit. Yes, he does. Mm-hmm. With the wide nostrils and the not long cartilage.
Oh, this guy looks like a baby RE.
Yep. Yes, he does. Only darker. Yes, he does.
And his name's Neil.
Neil.
He was kneeling down. I said, what's your name? That was all I got was him kneeling down. They teach their kids real young to hide and be quiet and just freeze wherever they are. If somebody, Earth human, comes around, just freeze.
Green boy. Look at this guy. Mm-hmm. How old is Green boy?
You know, 5, 6 maybe.
Yeah.
Hey, if you wanted to share any, like if there's anything outstanding that you wanted to share about any of these guys?
I'll let you know. Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Absolutely.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
out from behind, you will frequently see the little kids peeking out with just one eye from wherever they're hiding.
Yep.
They clap just like we do. You see our toddlers do this with their hands when even before they're one.
See, and like this, yeah, this guy almost looks like a chimpanzee.
He does, doesn't he? And very, very similar to that ridge structure. The one thing that we find similar to the great ape family and the Sasquatch family is the roundness of the eyes versus the oblong ovalness of the eyes. And most of the adult Sasquatch, you can see almost no white sclera in their eye. No, you see all the colored part with very little white. That's because their irises are so big. But just like us, Sasquatch are born with their adult size eyes. The eyes don't grow in us. What size they are that we're born, it's the size they stay.
Wow, another little guy.
Yep.
Oh, now that guy looks very much human.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
He's a marble guy, too.
He is a marble guy. And in fact, we encourage people to use different colored marbles and make patterns. Put them out, take a picture of it, leave. When you come back, consult your picture and see if they changed the order.
This is amazing, the diversity. Like, this guy looks like a totally like a human. And like I said, one guy looked like a chimpanzee. I wonder why that is. It's such a difference.
Same difference in us. If you take somebody who's Nordic and compare them to somebody who is Aboriginal Australian, you wouldn't even think that they were the same species.
Yeah.
So yeah, the diversity exists in our population too.
Oh, of course.
Mm-hmm. Lots of fine hair on the face for them.
Oh, dreadlocks.
Mm-hmm. And braids.
Yeah.
You will find them, especially the gals, taking mud in their hair and making essentially a dreadlock. They love the children. If they find our children alone in the forest, they will try their utmost to protect them.
Well, this seems like the parents wanted drawings of their children. Isn't that like
some of it was?
Yeah.
Some of it was something that they had the kids had talked about, or the parents had talked about the toddler doing or the child doing recently.
Aw. Sweet.
You ever see those weavings where they take and wrap something?
Yeah. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
This is mom teaching daughter.
Yeah. When my wife moved into her new place, they actually left a little woven human figure right in her kitchen. Right in her kitchen. Like she looked, she was there, looked back, and it was there kind of thing, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yes, I have seen that.
Yep. I like that one.
Yeah.
That was requested for Father's Day, if I remember right.
You
want
to see it again?
I think so, last year or 2 years ago.
So the
I love this one.
Yeah, that one, that little guy. Some of them have very thin lips like you would see a great ape have. Others have very thick lower lips and a thin upper lip. Some of them have thin, full lips all the way around. And so I just never knew what I was going to run into
with
them.
We have time to look at the it's a short video too.
Yeah, go
look
for
at
it.
The adults too, and then then we'll get down to how the RE thing, because like you said, it explains how and if people want to get a picture drawn from
and
you,
they can see
it explains the process, right?
Yep.
Okay.
They sure can.
So let me just find that.
While he's looking for that, could you say how many different conferences you've been at? Because I think you've been at a lot of conferences.
No, not as many as you might think. 10 maybe at a stretch total.
That's 10 more than me. That's pretty good.
The only Sasquatch conference we've been to thus far was the Psychic and Spiritual Sasquatch Retreat that Kiwani and Kelly Lapsaritis had started in 16. And we went to that 4 years in a row, and then COVID hit. And we've been home since then.
But I have a whole host of drawings here that I've saved that I could mat up and sell very, very quickly. A couple hundred.
Wow. Hundred
of, here you go.
Both the Star People and Sasquatch? Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah. Both. Yeah. 600-700 drawings, something like that.
Enough.
Enough. Whoop. That's what this one's called. Whoop.
Whoop. Whoop.
Whoop. Yep, exactly.
Oh, look at Rocky.
Rocky. Like him. He was great.
He looks like a pretty cool guy.
I will draw an initial rough draft and then set it out and overnight let them have a chance to come look at it and correct me. And then I'll draw again with whatever corrections, set it out again, let them correct that one. And with Rocky, it was a step-by-step process. Oh, five or six drafts.
So when we get to the RE one, you haven't got to that process yet.
No, not yet. It's just at its first rough draft stage.
Yeah, yeah.
The two that I sent you. Yes, very rough. Needs lots of help.
I want to look at that again. Just give me a second.
Yeah. Father and son.
Look at that little guy.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Gives you a chance to see the size of the adult faces as compared. And they get along with most everybody in the forest, although they sometimes don't always get along with the coyotes. They'll howl with them, but the coyotes are more packish. The wolves tend to be more loyal to them.
Yeah.
They find more intelligence in the wolves.
I had a really nice experience with a wolf man, with a dog man.
Yeah.
They're amazing, sweet, sweet people.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. We know that we have some areas here in New Mexico that are dog man kind of territory.
But for them, you pretty much got to be friends with the Sasquatch people or with the Star people for them to trust you.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes, you do. So this was Kie, before Kie turned 20. This is a couple years ago, I guess. Radar and Kie were having a good time.
They just these are best buds?
They are. They're best buds. They're best buds. Some of these were from the kids, and you can flip past them if you've seen them before.
Oh, look at that. Yeah, that's that one.
That's the Starstruck one. Yeah. I like that little guy.
That one's beautiful.
That's some wood.
He was maybe...
I gotta bring that back. Hang on a second.
He was maybe not quite 2 feet tall. That's why I put him way down in the corner.
Oh, shoot. Sorry.
That's all right. That's okay.
What was it? Was that a Sasquatch or was that just another
a woodman? He's a little guy that stays little. The little people of the forest that look like Sasquatch but miniature. Some of those we call woodmen, and that's what he was. Kind of like the flint nappers we had talked about that nap the bird arrowhead points for the crow historically. That's where his people were from, that northern end of the Rockies.
Are those the kind of people who live in Hawaii? Because I heard there's a little
people. Metahuli are the guys that live in Hawaii. They have their own brand of folks like him, but yes, similar.
Very similar.
Mm-hmm. What's his personality like? He looks mischievous as heck.
He is, but you don't want to make him mad because they hold on to grudges for a while. So you got to stay on the good side of some of these guys. Many of them will avoid Earth humans like the plague. And you only see signs of them when you see their structures on the down at your feet, beneath your knees, most of them. Only you'll see the same arches secured with a rock. You'll see the same X's in the ground. You'll see the same little glyphs things by the side of where they live. You'll see the same artwork, only in miniature in stones. And so all of the things that Big Brother Sasquatch does, these guys do.
You know, I probably come across some of their stuff.
You probably have.
Minute little things.
Start looking down at your
feet. Size.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And
that looks like Sasquatch stuff, but it's just tiny.
Yeah. Those guys are seen on craft too.
Yes, they are. And they
They don't often leave footprints because they aren't that heavy.
Oh, sweet.
This charcoal gray skin tone that you see in these last couple, very common. Almost black skin, not quite. There's a hint of charcoal gray in there.
I like this guy.
Mm-hmm. I liked him too. He was in the middle of building stuff. And I said, can you show me what you're building? He said, when I get up. That red tone to the eye sockets that you see, they're retina bioluminesce, meaning they create their own light at night. And so when the retina light up, you see red eyes glowing from the forest, or amber or white sometimes, but frequently you will see, especially with the darker skin toned individuals, the eyes are red versus the lighter skin tones, we see a variation. I don't know why that is, but the guys with the charcoal skin tend to have red eyes at night.
Okay.
I don't know why. I just know that we've noticed a pattern.
Yeah.
Very lonely.
She's very lonely. Moki. I love Moki Bear. Moki Sasquatch.
That's an older adult there.
Mm-hmm. Huh? Mm-hmm.
There's one of your Pawnee people.
Yeah, that's Radar and Kie again. That was in 19, so that was 2 years ago. We don't know who was saying it to who.
Well, it looked like Moke or your Pawnee was saying it because it had the finger point.
Mm-hmm.
That's normal for Radar.
Yeah, I know.
Went that away.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, watermelon.
They do like watermelon. In fact, when people say, what kinds of food should we take them? And I have shirts and mugs with Butterfly Boy on them. He was the first one we printed up and took to the conference.
He's cute.
I liked him. I liked how his hands came out.
Yes. Beautiful. More Tootsies.
We saw that
one. We'll run through it. There's only a few minutes. That's a nice one. Oh, that's a good one.
They do have twins like we have, sometimes triplets.
Chokeweed, man.
We got it with Raj Asay, the female up here has
chokeweed.
Uh-huh. Chokeweed was their phrase for marijuana.
And we learned this at Estes Park at a conference.
I learned it from a female Sasquatch.
Yeah.
I had no idea that they understood herbalism
to that magnitude.
Yep. There's a whole story about it.
It makes sense, though. It's just a common.
She said it was very easy to find growing in Colorado. No joke.
Look at that guy. It looks like a Buddha.
Yeah.
Looks like you, Beans.
Yeah. Oh, that was another thing. This was one of the more petite, 4 foot tall, maybe, guys. There was a wild cat or a mountain lion with him, and he literally had a spear that had a arrowhead point on it about 3-4 inches long that was snapped, and they hunted together and wanted me to portray them as hunting together. That was the request on his part.
Do they have pets or kind of like
yes babies? Yeah, any stray baby that they find in the forest that is wolf cub, bear cub, mountain lion, et cetera, et cetera. If they find it as an infant, they will take care of it and become friends and adopt it into their family. They don't refer to it as a pet, but they do refer to it as a companion.
They've actually taken my little Chihuahua dog. He just recently passed, but they've taken him and played with him for periods of time. And I actually wasn't that happy about it, but they always brought him back. No, I mean, you know, because
at least they didn't need him.
Yeah.
But I know they did.
Their societies are matriarchal. What the clan grandmothers say goes. Yeah, I wanted to.
Just like sort of like the Native Indians, right? The women were kind of.
That's right.
The clan mothers.
The clan mothers say what to do, and the clan fathers get it done.
That's the chief.
Yep. Yep. I asked them, I knew they threw logs as a warning, and I wanted to know how they threw them. And he just picked it up with one hand and chucked it. I went, oh, that was easy. So.
Beautiful stuff. Beautiful stuff.
When I do stuff for the Sasquatch now, or for the Pontee, I always ask them if they have a preference, what they wanted as a pose. And I've started some things that they've asked me to get better on. But I will do things like a study in Sasquatch feet and hands and noses and sometimes just eyes. When I was trying to get to an understanding of doing their eyes correctly. And sometimes they don't have a preference. They just have me pick something for them or suggest something. You know how if you go have your portrait done in a portrait studio, sometimes you have no idea what kind of a pose you need to do. Well, they don't know either. And so I end up talking about possibles and the feel of what they want when it's done. And when I talked to Ari about the portrait of him, the first thing that came across for him was this jolly old soul, almost heyoka, as in using humor to teach. Very old, very wise. Almost like you see the grandfather who is totally unconcerned what other people think about what he does, says, or is. And he's just himself no matter what. Likes getting a rise out of people sometimes. And so when I first started his portrait, it was that jolly old soul, laughter, teaching through humor that he wanted portrayed first and foremost. And I had to kind of understand, because I hadn't met him before, what his hair was like. And I knew that it was white to white blonde. That was about as much as I had. I didn't know how broad across the shoulders he was. I knew he was taller on average than, say, the 8-9 feet that you see in most of North America. But when I did him, I said, so do you want daylight, moonlight? Do you want to sit? Do you want to stand? What do you like to do in your off hours? And he said, I tell stories. Okay. What kind of stories? Funny ones. So he takes the foibles of all of the stories he's heard from clans all over and uses them as teaching tools for the grandchildren age of his own clan area, and is always looking for more stories and more things to share. But his first goal is to get people relaxed and laughing. That was the first thing, is to put people at ease. That was the big part I got when I was first starting to draw Ari, is I'm not threatening. I'm not going to throw anything at you. Well, nothing big anyway. And it was kind of like that from the very beginning. Hang on.
It sounds so much like what I hear from the, you know, the tribal Americans, you know, who they're always telling stories and funny stories, and then they weave in their teachings.
Mm-hmm. Verbal teaching history. They have the glyph language that you see written in sticks and stones and leaves and things on the ground.
Yep.
Pardon me. I'm getting over this cough. And I've got something stuck in my throat that's making my eyes water even.
With the lime and the coconut, yeah. Drink it all up.
Nope, this one is jasmine.
Me cola.
Yeah, really.
I say the ta-ta.
So anyway, when I first started drawing Ari, he asked to be sitting down, not standing. And he stuck his foot out like this. He said, can I show you my big feet?
Oh, my God. Yeah, that sounds
so
like
so I went, hold that pose. So that's why in the first rough draft you see of his, the first things you see are the foot out this way and the other big foot underneath it because he had one leg crossed over a knee. But I still haven't gotten from him. He's got one hand up here by his chest, and I still haven't gotten from him if he wants something held in that hand yet. And when I started adding the skin tone color to him, because his hair was white, but his skin was this beautiful coffee color, mahogany color, with red tones to it. And I thought, oh, that's just gorgeous. So you have his dark, dark, deep skin tone with his halo of white hair around him. And so when I first did the original sketch of him, a rough draft of him sitting, I didn't feel like I was representing that part, that distinction between the color of the hair and the color of the skin tone well enough. So he had me start a second one to show me the distinct differences. And that's why you had a second one behind the first one. That first one I may end up redoing and just starting from scratch again with the same pose. But it was when you first work with chalk and paper, the chalk part, just like pencils, is erasable. And so I just have kneadable erasers that I use, and if I goof it up, I'll erase it and start over. But after a while, the nap on the paper wears off after so much work and erasing. And the paper is either saturated or it's been erased to the point where it's not going to accept any more chalk. And so if it gets to that point and I'm not happy with it, then I'll start again with the same pose. And it will go 10 times faster because I've gone through the learning curve of, all right, how big is your nose? And what color are your eyes? And do we even see your eye color? And what pose do you want? And how big are your shoulders? Some of these guys' shoulder width is huge because here's 3 feet. And their shoulder width is like this.
At least 5.
And I'm going, wow.
He's one of those big guys.
He really is, and I've had to, honest to God, study extremely muscular animals and great apes, human beings, and other animals that stand upright to look at what do ginormous shoulders look like when you look at just the musculature. When I do some portraits, I will start with an outline of what I want to get done as far as the face or the body posture. Like if I'm going to do something like this, I'll just roughly, lightly sketch things first before I start adding other details. And other times I do work that are what I call a study in the no erase method. And what I mean by that is I'll take a single color like white on black and do a sketch like this with absolutely zero correction and erasing and knock it off in less than a half an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And so that for me is a good practice, but it means I really have to be in tune with whoever it is and know what it is that they're wanting. And
it gives me a chance to study the different faces and eyes and noses and mouths and hairlines in ways that I got to get it right the first time. So I'm just extra diligent about my observations before I get the pen down.
I want to ask you some questions about what happened with RE or whatever.
Sure.
But something just occurred to me.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I've had past lives as Sasquatch. Mm-hmm. Are you a channeler as well?
I can channel. I have
channeled. Because I was wondering.
That part's easy.
Would you ever consider, this would be interesting. Think about this. Would you ever consider channeling like somebody who's had a past life as a Sasquatch, actually drawing what they look like? Isn't that interesting?
Yes, that I could do. I would have to.
That's really cool.
I would have to really study you for a while and see if I can access that information clearly enough to do it.
Yeah.
Because when I look at individuals from past lives like that, you're asking for a Sasquatch from who knows how long ago who might have access to their reflection in water, but not a mirror.
Right.
So until we developed mirrors of some kind, we didn't look at ourselves in detail.
Right.
We looked at all of our family members in detail, but not ourselves. And so it's not infrequent that I tap into people like from long ago who can tell me what everything around them looked like, tell me what their hands look like, tell me what their feet look like, but not necessarily have a real clear idea of their own face look.
Yeah.
Well, possibly you could tap into their sister or their brother or something.
That's right. And therein lies the solution. Yeah. You're absolutely right.
Grandchild.
If there is another family member who can say, this is right, this is wrong, this is right, that's wrong.
Yeah. It's easier. Fascinating that you could do
but
that.
But I'd never thought about it that way.
Draw somebody who lived a past life as a Sasquatch and present them with a picture of what they looked like at that time.
A lot of people have past life as another from off world, you know, from Palladians or Assyrians or something. Sure. I bet you they'd like to have pictures of those too. That would be
fascinating. Yeah. And I have begun a study in drawing other star nations that visit Earth on a regular basis. We have a few of them sketched out now. Dozen plus, maybe up to two dozen.
Yeah.
But that's all. Not all of them by any stretch of the imagination. And some of the aquatics we're still learning about because we just don't see them.
So when we were talking earlier, you had a big smile on your face. So obviously you had a fun time with RE. Do you want to describe his personality and what did you have small talk?
Hilarious.
What happened?
The first time I ever talked to him, he was just real casual.
He's like, because, who are you? What do you want?
Yeah. Basically a little bit humorously challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And what do I mean by that? What do you want? Uh-huh. And then wait to see what the response is, because he wants to see if you'll come back at him and treat him with the same kind of humor and directness that he treats you with.
That's him.
Very direct, very upfront, very emotionally, boom. And most of the time when I'm dealing telepathically with a Sasquatch.
Bigger than life personality.
Oh, my God. The energy level is huge.
I don't want him coming in the door.
No, to have them come into the house and have to stoop to bend over from the waist and the shoulders just to get their head in the room.
He's with me right now. Can you feel him? I'm feeling his energy right now.
On his right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A big time energy. So he came in and that's, you're describing his personality. Exactly. He's a comic and he likes to trade one liners and like,
he kind does
sarcastic kind of kind of comments, you know, like
he wanted to again sit down and show his big feet first. I have a big foot.
Yes, no kidding. Can it fit in your mouth?
I said, what do you want to sit on? He said, I'm stumped. So I drew him on a stump.
I'm stumped.
And of course, we had the picture of your rock in back of you. And I asked him about his nose because I knew the first time I drew his nose. And in fact, in the two rough drafts you have, it's still not big enough.
No.
No, not even. He has a huge Jimmy Durante sort of cartilage at the end of his
hook
nose.
On the end
that's
of his
wise
nose. Yeah.
And protrudes down to a hook over. And
that's kind of like my Sauron friend.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
But we know that some of the nations here in New Mexico have very large noses like that too, because they are known as the Long Nose Clan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so it didn't surprise me, but when I first drew his nose, he went bigger, and then he snorted, and he snorted out his nose. You don't want to know what came out. So it was just
puppies.
No, it wasn't purple. So we oftentimes can get kids to sit still if we offer them food. You know, they'll sit there and eat and stay in one place. Otherwise, they're running around just like any other kids are. And he wasn't a whole lot different. And it's, what do you got?
He had a new playground in your mind.
We have 17 different kinds of fruit trees we grow in our backyard. We have a half an acre in town here. And we extensively garden it. And we always leave the fruit at the top of the trees for the Sasquatch. Always. Yeah. The top, well, I suppose, 10% plus, 15% of the tree, we let be so that apples and cherries and peaches and plums and pears and jujubes and figs that are all there for
choke
their picking
cherries
anytime they want to come.
Yeah.
You're
and
in Albuquerque?
So, yes.
Yeah?
Yes,
yeah,
we're in the Albuquerque metro area. So,
my condolences.
Yeah, we live at a mile-high altitude. So when I first got here, I had to get used to the thin air. Because I was used to living at sea level. But Ari, when he first sat down, there was just this massiveness about him that had a jovialness. In one way, he reminded me of a great big white hairy Santa Claus. Doesn't mind giving gifts, doesn't mind flipping something at people.
More abominable.
Yeah, kind of.
More
kind
abominable.
Of like the abominable snowman.
Snowman, yeah.
Almost. But it was the willingness to sit there for however long it took. And still willing to sit there. And when I first started sketching him just in black and white before I started adding skin tone color.
Was he commenting all the way along?
Like, oh, yes, of course. Of course.
In a funny way, like, nah.
It was more like, all right, how's this?
I had to turn bigger. The sound up on the movie I was watching. He was so damn loud.
We get to laughing sometimes. Have you heard his belly laugh? He does this throaty
big,
chuckle
yeah.
first before a big belly laugh. Yeah. But you'll hear the... You don't know
let me get this
job
straight.
Of the hut or what?
Let me get this straight for the audience. When you're doing a mind speak with him, White Otter can hear you, Reverend? Can hear you hear him too?
Sure.
I can. Okay. I'm sitting right next to her.
That's what I'm saying. I just wanted to set the table so that
and you
so
know
both
that's
of
a fair
you can
question.
Hear him talk telepathically
right.
from you know.
Because
Canada.
He's in public mode, he's not in private one-on-one. When you speak with somebody telepathically, you can direct your thoughts only to one person, only to the one receiver. That's a private conversation. You can direct it to anybody in a local area, like anybody else who might be living or hearing in the living room.
Yeah.
All right. Who's a telepath? They could hear it. Or you can have a calling that's a long distance shouting from point A to point B telepathically, as in, hey, I'm trying to get a hold of you. Listen up here. And reach out to wherever that is, however you need to do it. So in telepathic speak, you can select
the size of your audience and the members of your audience that you want to hear you.
But what he doesn't realize is that our connection is so close that sitting 3 feet away from each other, I'm still picking up 80, 90% of what she's either hearing or seeing. Wow. She's projecting it right to me.
He participates in the process. And in fact, I think when I was doing that, he saw the shoulders and that we had done the first rough draft with, and he said, you know, those are going to have to be bigger. I said, same thing with the nose.
So, and to the finish up, the telepathy is both verbal and visual.
It can so there's be both.
A visual, there's a visual
right.
aspect.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Most definitely.
You can get images as well as words, as well as emotion, as well as map images or calendar feel, past, present, future feel, intensity of energy feel. If something is really, really terrible and loud, like an explosion, and somebody projects the idea of, I went through this explosion to you telepathically, you may feel it. You may feel that reverb and get knocked right. back. So when people speak with you telepathically from a telepathic nation, they have the capability of sending it hard, fast, and strong, or just real easy and gentle. That's their choice. Just like you have the choice of whispering to somebody versus screaming across the room if there's an emergency. Help!
Yeah.
Okay. Same thing with our communication.
When I showed you that picture of him, the photobomb picture, you saw him like, I obviously saw him really clear because it was for me, right? But you saw him right here, right?
Oh, easily. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But so, I've also figured out how to look at pictures and pick out where they are and how close to the camera they are and more details than most, because I'm an artist that's used to working in blacks, whites, and grays. And so seeing that gray tone fog, for me picking out details in it is no problem. I'm used to doing it.
Yeah. And that's a great picture.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, one thing I think we kind of overlooked too when we were talking about the telepathy 101 primer.
What's that?
Well, because of the emotional roller carrier wave of mm-hmm. telepathy. And even when it's physical, it still has emotion tied to it.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that the telepathy primer is designed to get you closer to your heart, to your true self, energetically, through self-awareness and mm-hmm. change.
Right.
And so, which we didn't really talk about.
No, it. When you study and try and improve yourself so that you can speak with telepathic nations, the side effect is you end up working on yourself. You end up improving your conscious contact with the unseen world, as well as your friends, your family, your coworkers. You tend to find ways to be right-minded instead of not, because you realize that there's a value to it. And life is easier once you figure out that walk with a foot in each world.
Yeah.
Anyway, I don't know if you want to show those rough drafts of our
absolutely idea. I was trying to find that.
Yeah, find
that,
a good
that photo bomb picture, but
yeah, I have it somewhere. But
I just because anyway, so I just wanted to before we get to the picture, and we'll clarify that it's very rough. It's going to be
very rough. This is first draft stage with lots of corrections. And in fact, if you want me to, as I change from this first rough draft to final draft, if you want me to take pictures along the way so that you see the transition from rough to final, we can do that.
Oh,
I have an example of that online in a very short video I did called Banjo the Rock Mover. And Banjo was a Sasquatch who came to me when I had first started drawing a practice picture, not thinking I was drawing anybody in particular, and suddenly he showed up and started correcting everything that I did. And you see the progression in about 10 steps from where I started to something completely different when I ended up. And so I will do that same process,
with your friend Ari, with both of these rough drafts that I've started, and just take progression pictures along the way so you can see the progress as it goes.
Absolutely. So just before we get to the pictures, did you have any small talk with him? Did he tell you anything that's worth noting, or?
He likes bacon. He likes ham. He really likes sweet fruits like melons. So we talked about food. We talked about...
what else is new with the Sasquatch?
We talked about aches and pains that you get when you're elderly, because he recognized the white hair and went, "You're not a young Earth human." And I said, "No, I'm not." And so as geriatric set, so to speak, we talked about what it's like to get older in each of our cultures. And so that was part and parcel of our discussion. He wanted to know about Otter's tremor and his Parkinson's. And so we talked about disease process and breaking bones and what happens if you eat something that's not right. And then that's where it segued to food and other things. So we talked a little bit about health things. We talked a little bit about food things. We talked a lot about what it's like dealing with the energetic youth that surround us. And he liked being off on his own, dealing with maybe one or two youngsters at a time if he was going to teach them, but not a whole group. If he was going to do storytelling, that's a whole different ball of wax, though, because he could storytell in front of a huge clan and hold court, so to speak, and enjoy doing it. But as far as one-on-one teaching, he liked to deal with, if it came to anybody under the age of 20, he liked one or two people at a time so that he could concentrate and make sure that he had their attention. So that was very different than the storytelling stuff.
I was going to say, I'll include the, because I can't find it and I don't want to, I want the continuity of the interview to go well. I know you don't, you want to probably wrap it up soon, but so I'll include the photobomber picture in the video.
Oh yeah, but, sure.
I was going to ask you, have you asked him? I mean, he is a master healer. Have you asked him to help you?
No, we have not. I don't ever presume to do that to somebody meeting them for the first time. Now, if they notice a problem and volunteer it on first meeting, that's an entirely different thing. But I don't want any of the visitors that I draw, whether they're Sasquatch, Ponte, or anybody else, to think that I'm doing this to get something from them.
I realize that, but it's a loving connection back and forth. I mean,
yeah,
I mean, I'm picking up that if he's asking about Otter's tremors, maybe he's wants you to say, "Well, hey, can you help him with it?"
Well, and next time we talk to him, we'll probably just talk a little bit more about health things. It's part of the reason that we bring up stuff and are real open about it, to segue into conversations about them culturally and what they do with individuals who are sick or who have become out of balance in whatever fashion, whether that's emotionally or physically or spiritually. We talked about everything from the normal rituals of life with the Sasquatch, from births to deaths and to...
You and Ari did.
I only talked with Ari about the geriatric things. I did not ask him about births. And because we were talking about our own geriatrics, I didn't really want to bring up death. So you didn't go there yet, but we have had those discussions with other Sasquatch peoples because it's part of their culture and we're still learning. So,
right. Well, let's bring his picture up. And like I say, I preface this with, like you said, this is just like a,
you'll see these kind of things
in about 10, 15 minutes, right?
That's right. This is the 15 minute, let me scribble something and get a general idea for them and go from there. Mm-hmm. And so in this particular one, the first one is of him sitting, again, you want to see my Bigfoot? I don't think his shoulders are wide enough. I don't think that his body length is strong enough. I know I still have to fix his forehead. Although what he was wanting me to see is you can still see his mahogany skin tone through the forehead. By the time I had gotten to this stage, the paper had already become saturated with white. I tried erasing and going over it, but I couldn't get it dark enough to that mahogany brown red tone that I was looking for. Like you see at the very bottom of his foot, the foot that's sticking out towards you, you see that reddish tone in the middle of it. That's what I was going for all of his skin tone. And so I'm not happy with this because of that. I also had to erase part of his glyph when I put the color in the foot, which I want that to be moved over and clearer. So there are a lot of things about this that are what I call the first rough work in progress, working out the kinks and the bugs.
I would say his nose is, I mean, and you know, like you said, this is very, very rough, but yeah, I agree. His shoulders are not big enough.
Not big enough, not wide enough.
And his nose is not big enough.
That's right. Needs to be a bigger proboscis. Yes.
But you know what? Cartilage. I think you've captured a lot of his personality.
The feel of him as in, I want to show you a big toothy grin and the jolliness. You might see an even larger smile on him the next time around, but I still will do him with his foot kicked out. I still will do him seated. I don't know if he'll have something in his hand or not. I'm still letting him decide on that. But his proportions here have to change for me to be happy with it. So I'm going to start this one again now that I have a feel for what he wants.
Yeah.
Does he have a receding hairline? Is a little bald at the top?
Yes. His hair was receding and had been since he was 60.
He's doing that in honor of you, Mr. Beans. But look how human he looks.
Because he had hair from here on down, he had chin hair. I did not see a mustache on him. That surprised me. I will make sure that that's correct. But I did not see a mustache on him.
I don't think he has
one. I was shocked. So we'll
I'll look at it closer.
Yeah, we'll get some confirmation on some of these details. So go flip to the
next. Ask Brian if Brian was his father in the last lifetime.
Yeah, I was going to ask, you know what? Beans were getting mad. I was going to say, do you say anything about me? But
no, we actually didn't do a lot of talk about you. But if it happens, I'll keep it in mind to remember to tell you.
Because him and I are pretty close.
Yeah, I know you are. I know you are.
Extremely close. Mm-hmm.
One real quick, and then I've got to go do a bio break, and we better wrap this up.
Oh, look at that.
I haven't eaten anything
there
today.
He is.
All right, so you can see the deeper mahogany skin tone is getting there. His nose has still got to come down and be almost twice as big on the end of it.
Yeah, I think so, too,
His shoulders have to be wider than this. These are wider than the other ones, but they have to be bigger. Proportionally, what you don't see is he had a hell of a double chin. And so when his chin was down like this, you saw lots of extra material here folding, and you don't see it as clearly here as I would like. And that's where sometimes with the Sasquatch, I have to get the skin in first and the hair is actually last, because I can always couch hair around skin. But to try and change skin after you've added hair is much harder.
Oh,
much, much harder. So getting the facial expression was more important. And in this one, there's not enough lines under the eyes for my liking. He had more ridges under here that extended from the nose. You know how they have folds across the bridge of the nose? Well, his went under his eyes, and they are not portrayed in this and need to be. He's got a little more length to the face as well as the roundness, and I wasn't happy with this view yet. So we're going to work on this.
Cheeks should be a little
one.
Fuller.
They do. They need to be fuller. I'm agreeing.
So as you have been saying, he's giving you input all along the way, right?
Right, right. As I do something wrong, he points it out.
So what is he happy with that picture?
He's happy with the color of the skin tone. He's happy with the glint in the eyes.
Yeah.
He says that the smile could be bigger. He's not afraid to show his tongue. And in fact, he went, he liked the, when I talked to him about getting the details of his hair correct, in the cream colors, the ambers, the chocolate brown shadow lines. He liked that idea. He says that his jawline is rounder down here, and you see more of it, but I don't have the chin area correct yet. And his forehead slopes more, and this makes him appear round-headed, and he's not. And so I need to correct that large, massive cranium. And so I may need to make this so that you can see that a little bit easier. Whether or not we start this again or correct this is, I'm waiting to hear from him one way or the other. And again, you're looking at maybe 20 minutes worth of work here.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, just a real fast. And then it was dark and I didn't have the light to keep going with color because that takes daylight. You can do only so much in light bulb, incandescent light.
How did you perceive, was he, you know, like people are honored or whatever when people take pictures or draw them or whatever. Did you get that feeling of him that he was very excited about having his picture?
Oh, curious. Oh, absolutely, yeah. Curious. Nobody had ever talked to him about drawing him before. He was like, what? You can do that? Okay. Can I see? And so the curiosity of the process. When you sit for a portrait in front of an artist, as the person who's being drawn, you have this inner curiosity to see what the progress is like.
Right.
And so to keep him from to sitting down and not coming up and around and kibitzing and to stay put long enough to do something was the trick for me. Gentlemen, I am so sorry, but I am going to need to let you go. My belly is telling me that okay. I am hungry. I've got to go take a bio break because we've been sitting talking for hours. This has been delightful. I surely appreciate it. And we might have to
do it again.
We're going to have to do it again. Yeah. But tonight, I think so. Just in closing, does he not look almost more human than any Sasquatch you've ever drawn? Person? I mean, he looks completely human here.
He runs a close first with a couple.
He runs very close. You will see more squatchiness come out when I get the ridges under the eyes coming off the nose.
Yeah.
That part is the missing part. When you see the large proboscis, the end of the nose curved down, you will see it more in him.
Mm-hmm.
This is such a great show. I'm so glad. Yeah. I was excited as I was singing this morning because I knew it was going to be a fun show.
Oh, so I'm glad you had a good time.
We really enjoyed it. So generally, guys, I ask people to give us, you know, an overview or whatever, but we will do that next time. That means you have to come back.
Well, come back then. That sounds like we have
to
come back.
But I'm so honored to have had a you, Sue, this has and, been fun. And
thank you, Hat,
and Reverend what?
Whitewater Otter.
I almost said White Owl. White Otter.
Uh oh. You have another nickname. All right, my dears.
I'm not a messenger of bad news.
Yep.
Let me just do my closing thing, okay?
Okay, real fast.
Okay.
So thank you to Sue Walker and Reverend White Otter for gracing us with their presence on our show and all the beautiful insight and stuff that we shared and really had a lot of energy all through it. So the Sasquatch are definitely, well, RE is definitely checking in. So on behalf of Port Cunningham and Frank Oliver Baines, the world's handsomest man, and from the two most ascended disasters in the known universe, we would like to thank Sue Walker and Reverend White Otter for stopping in and gracing our show today. And thank you everybody for watching. And we will see you next time. Oh, and by the way, you're the first show of season 3.
Hey!
We're on a mission to save the world.
Sounds good to me. We'll help.
Yep.
All right, guys.
All right,
guys. We got to run.
Yep.
Blessings.
Bye.
Love you. Bye.
happy trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then.
Who cares about the clouds if we're together?
Just sing a song and bring the sunny weather.